कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय, अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय, निताई गौर प्रेमानंदे हरि बोल। सो थैंक यू वंस अगेन वेरी मच डियर डिवोटीज फॉर काइंडली इनवाइटिंग मी हियर टुडे टू स्पीक समथिंग ऑन द नाइन पिलर्स ऑफ श्री मध्वाचार्यस फिलोसफी। सो दिस इज द टॉपिक ऑफ आवर प्रेजेंटेशन टुडे, नाइन पिलर्स ऑफ श्री मध्वाचार्यस फिलोसफी। एंड I would like to begin my presentation on this topic. Once again, I am very thankful to you, Amogh Lila Prabhu, to Jai Dwarka Prabhu, to all the wonderful devotees at ISKCON Dwarka for kindly inviting me here and giving me this opportunity to speak something about such a great Acharya, such a prominent Acharya in our Sampradaya. Sri Madhvacharya, in it is said in the Madhva Sampradaya, na madhava samo devo na cha madhva samo guru. In Hindi we will say Bhagwan Madhav ke saman koi devta nahi hai aur Madhva ke saman koi guru nahi hai, or in English we will say there is no deity equivalent to Lord Madhav, there is no guru equivalent to Shri Madhva. So this is our glorification of Sri Madhvacharya. And in our Sampradaya, he holds such a vital place, such an important place. Therefore, our Sampradaya is known as Brahma Madhva Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya. So that is the name of our Sampradaya, Brahma Madhva Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya. Sometimes some individuals say that our Sampradaya is completely distinct from Madhvacharya Sampradaya, it is not connected to Madhvacharya Sampradaya. But the fact is that our previous Acharyas have clearly, in their books, they have mentioned this connection with Sri Madhvacharya. Sri Kavi Karnapur in his Gaur Ganodesh Deepika has clearly mentioned Sri Madhvacharya as the Acharya of our lineage. Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan in his Prameya Ratnavali has clearly mentioned Sri Madhvacharya's name in his lineage. So therefore, these prominent Acharyas have clearly mentioned the link with Sri Madhvacharya. And anybody who is unbiased will carefully consider this and unbiasedly accept that Sri Madhvacharya is in fact, you know, we are connected to him in lineage. So if we are connected to Sri Madhvacharya in lineage, then why are we not exactly following the rules, rituals, regulations that they follow? Because, you know, their tilak itself is different, our tilak is different. There are some differences. If we are in Madhvacharya Sampradaya, we should follow the exact point to point. So the point is, we are Shakha Bhed. Shakha Bhed means we are a branch of the Sampradaya. See, the a branch is connected to the main trunk, yet a branch also has a distinct identity of its own. Please try to understand what is the meaning of Shakha Bhed. Shakha Bhed means a branch is connected to the main trunk, but it also has distinct qualities of its own. Fruits grow on a branch. Fruits don't grow on the main trunk. So similarly, this fruit of Krishna Prem, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Gaur Prem has grown on the Shakha of Sri Madhva Sampradaya. So this is what we are exactly. We are a Shakha Ved, or we are a branch of Sri Madhvacharya's Sampradaya. So today it is my great good fortune that I am presenting these nine pillars of Sri Madhvacharya's philosophy for ISKCON of Dwarka, New Delhi. Now, before I begin, I'd like to begin with an introduction to Sri Madhvacharya and who better than Srila Prabhupada to introduce the personality. So I will begin with the words of Srila Prabhupada, and Srila Prabhupada is going to speak about the appearance of Sri Madhvacharya and some of the main works of Sri Madhvacharya. So let's see what Srila Prabhupada says. Srila Prabhupada says, Sripad Madhvacharya took his birth near Udupi, just west of Sahyadri. This is the chief city of the South Kannada province, basically South Karnataka province, and is near the city of Mangalore, which is situated to the south of Udupi. Near the city of Udupi is a place called Pajaka Kshetra. So many of us might have visited Pajaka Kshetra in our Tirtha Yatras, where Madhvacharya took his birth in a Shivalli Brahmana dynasty as the son of Madhya Geha Bhatta. So his father's name, Srila Prabhupada mentions, is Madhya Geha Bhatta. In the year 1040 Shakabda, or that is 1118 AD. According to some, he was born in the year 1160 Shakabda, or 1238 AD. So this Srila Prabhupada is mentioning this in the purport to Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela, 9th chapter, verse number 245. So Srila Prabhupada has spoken this thing. Srila Madhvacharya's father's name is Madhya Geha Bhatta. So what is the meaning of Madhya Geha? Madhya Geha means he whose home is in the center of the village. That is the meaning of Madhya Geha. So Madhya Geha Bhatta is his father's name. Mother's name is Vedavati. So please, dear devotees, mother's name of Sri Madhvacharya is Vedavati, is the name. Such an auspicious name, Vedavati. So Vedavati is the name of Saraswati, because she is always endowed with the four Vedas. So Vedavati is the name of Sri Madhvacharya's mother. So this information, because Srila Prabhupada has given two different years of birth for Sri Madhvacharya's appearance. So some are saying 1118 AD, some say 1238 AD. So there is a difference of 100 years, approximately 120 years in these two appearance dates. The difference of these two appearance dates is because there was a German scholar. His name was Dr. Buchanan. And Dr. Buchanan, he did extensive research in this province of South Kannada, that is South Karnataka. And in this research, he found out these two dates. And he printed these two dates in his publication called a District Manual of South Kannada. Now, after publishing this in this manual was accepted by many Vidwans. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur also accepted the conclusions of this manual, and he printed it in his commentary to Chaitanya Charitamrita. From Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's commentary, Srila Prabhupada took it as it is, and he has given it as it is in his own commentary on Chaitanya Charitamrita. So whatever information we have about Sri Madhvacharya's birth date, birth year, it comes from this source, District Manual of South Kannada, by a German scholar whose name is Dr. Buchanan. Now, his exact date of appearance in the Sampradaya is Ashwin Shukla Dashami, which means the 10th night or 10th day of the bright fortnight of the month of Ashwin. This is the appearance day of Sri Madhvacharya on the Vaishnava calendar. So in Vedic calendar, this is how dates are marked, Ashwin Shukla Dashami. So this is how we are marking the appearance day of Sri Madhvacharya. Now, Srila Prabhupada and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur and all the previous historians also have recorded the literary works of Sri Madhvacharya. How many works did Sri Madhvacharya compose mainly? So what are the main works of Sri Madhvacharya? This is what we have to see. So if we see the main works of Sri Madhvacharya, we will find that there are approximately 30 works which are said to be composed by him. First is his Gita Bhashya. Gita Bhashya means It is his commentary on the Bhagavad Gita. Then he wrote another explanation called as Gita Tatparya Nirnaya. Another explanation on Bhagavad Gita. Then is his Brahma Sutra Bhashya. Brahma Sutra Bhashya is his commentary on the Vedanta Sutras. Then is his Bhagavat Tatparya Nirnaya. And it is his commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam. Then he wrote Bharat Tatparya Nirnaya, which is his small explanation on the Mahabharata. Then he has written Dashopanishad Bhashya. Then his commentary on the 10 Upanishads. Isha, Katha, Kena, Prashna, Mundak, Pandukya, Aitare, Taitare, Chandogya, and Brihadaranyaka. This Dashopanishad Bhashya. So he has written his commentary on 10 Upanishads. Then Rig Bhashya. This is a small explanation of selected hymns of the Rig Veda. Then Anubhashya is another concise commentary on his Brahma Sutra Bhashya. So another concise explanation of his Brahma Sutra Bhashya. Then there is Krishnamrita Maharanava. This is like his Hari Bhakti Vilas, explaining why Ekadashi should be followed, when should it be followed. Ekadashi is of two types, mixed Ekadashi, pure Ekadashi, all those things are covered here. Then is Tantra Sar. Tantra Sar is all the practical deity worship related compilations. And Sadachar Smriti. Sadachar Smriti is also related to day-to-day, good behavior and worship of Lord Vishnu. Then there is his glorification of Lord Vishnu as the Supreme, Dwadasha Stotra. Then he has also written some Kavya Grantha. Kavya means some poetic works, which is Yamaka Bharata. The Mahabharata is being explained using the poetic figure of speech known as Yamaka. Yamaka means rhyme. So using rhyming words, he has explained Mahabharata. Then there is instructions for sannyasis in Yati Pranava Kalpa. Then he has explained about Janmashtami specifically. He has written a work called as Jayanti Nirnaya. The Jayanti is the exact date of appearance of Lord Krishna. In modern times, any person's birthday is, they call it Jayanti. But actually Jayanti refers only to the appearance day of Krishna. Not even the appearance day of Balram can be called as Jayanti. Only the appearance day of Krishna is called as Jayanti. Then there is another poetic work, Nakhastuti. Then Anuvyakhyan is another work on Vedanta. Nyaya Vivaran is all the Nyaya related concepts that are there in his Brahma Sutra Bhashya. He has put in Nyaya Vivaran. Then there is Praman Lakshanam, just like we say in, like we have Tattva Sandarbha, where all the Pramanas are given. So he also has a similar literature called as Pramana Lakshanam. Then Mayavad Khandanam is his work where he is trying to disprove the philosophy of Advaita Vad, which is also known as Mayavad. Then Upadhi Khandanam is another literature where he is disproving this philosophy of Vivartavad. Then Tattva Vivekaha and Tattva Sankhyanam, these two are about Tattva. What is Tattva? In Madhvacharya Sampradaya, there are two Tattvas. So just as Madhvacharya is always having two fingers, this is two Tattvas. What are the two Tattvas? One is Swatantra and one is Aswatantra. These are the two Tattvas. Swatantra is independent. Aswatantra is dependent. There are two Tattvas or two truths in Madhvacharya Sampradaya, Swatantra and Aswatantra. So these two truths are being, these two are known as Tattvas. So Swatantra is Lord Vishnu and Jiva is Paratantra, Aswatantra. So Vishnu and Jiva are the two Tattvas of Sri Madhva Sampradaya. So those are being explained in these Tattva Sankhyanam. And Prapancha Mithyatvanumana Khandanam is about disproving the impersonal philosophy that this world is mithya, or this world is false. And Tattva Udyotaha is also about Tattva, these two Tattvas that I spoke of. Katha Lakshanam is a very specific literature about how to have discussions based on Nyaya Shastra. Sometimes two people get into a debate. How to organize a proper debate? What are the characteristics of a proper debate? Who should be the judge of a proper debate? All these things. Then there is कर्म निर्णय, कर्म निर्णय इज ऑल्सो अबाउट सम एक्सप्लेनेशन अबाउट वैदिक वर्सेस, एंड विष्णु तत्व निर्णय इज ऑल्सो डिसाइडिंग अबाउट द सुप्रीमसी ऑफ लॉर्ड विष्णु. सो दीज आर इन शॉर्ट द डायरेक्टली रिटन वर्क्स ऑफ श्री मध्वाचार्य. दीज आर द मेन वर्क्स. देर आर सम अदर स्मॉलर वर्क्स ऑल्सो, बट दीज आर द मेन वर्क्स ऑफ श्री मध्वाचार्य दैट मोस्ट फॉलोअर्स ऑफ हिम रिफर टू. सो हैविंग सीन हिज वर्क्स, you know, we should understand that our sampraday, Gaudiya Vaishnava sampraday, is connected to Sri Madhvacharya sampraday, as we are a shakha bhed or a branch of Sri Madhvacharya sampraday. Our acharya Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan, in his Prameya Ratnavali, has glorified Sri Madhvacharya. So Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan has said in his Prameya Ratnavali, this is the verse that he has composed. I will try to sing this verse. Ananda Tirtha Nama Sukhamaya Dhamma Yatir Jiya Samsara Arnavataranim Yamiha Jana Kirtayanti Buddha. So he has said in his Prameya Ratnavali, Ananda Tirtha Nama Sukhamaya Dhamma Yatir. So Yati, may that sannyasi, who is Sukhamaya Dhamma, who is the abode of all happiness, Ananda Tirtha Nama, and whose name is Sri Ananda Tirtha, because Sri Madhvacharya's name, one of his name is Sri Ananda Tirtha. Jiyat, may he be victorious. Samsararanava Taranim, Yamiha Jana Kirtayanti Buddha. So Buddha Jana, intelligent souls, Kirtayanti, they glorify him in this world as Samsara Arnava Taranim, as a Taranim, as a boat to cross over the Arnav, the ocean of Samsara, of material world. So this is the translation. May the abode of happiness, Sri Madhvacharya, also known as Sri Ananda Tirtha, Yati, that is Sannyasi, be victorious. Intelligent souls glorify him as the perfect boat to cross over the ocean of material existence. So this is a verse composed by Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan in the glorification of Sri Madhvacharya. So direct indication that we are connected to him. Srila Jiva Goswami in his Tattva Sandarbha also acknowledges the importance of all the works that Sri Madhvacharya has composed, and he takes so many references from Sri Madhvacharya. So this is a small verse in his glorification, because before we begin speaking something about him, we should glorify a personality so that he will protect us on this path of explaining his philosophy. Now, before we begin explaining something, we should try to understand what is the name, meaning of the name Madhva, because it's a Madhva Acharya. So Acharya we understand, Achinoti Chashastarartham. We know the verse, we know one who, you know, practices what he is speaking, and whatever he speaks is from Shastra. That is Acharya. But what is the meaning of the name Madhva? Because sometimes some individuals mispronounce his name as Madhva Acharya or Madhava Acharya. No, no. The name is Madhva. Madhva Acharya. So the name is Madhva. And what is the meaning of the name Madhva? We have to see. So this was not his initial name. You know, in his childhood, his parents gave him the name Vasudev. So this is his childhood name, was Vasudev. Very auspicious name. And only after sannyas did he get the name Madhva. Or, you know, Madhva is actually, the meaning of Madhva is Madhuram. You know, this is Rig Veda. There is a term Madhva in Rig Veda 8th Mandal, 69th Sukta. Seventh hymn. So there is the term Madhva there, and Sayanacharya in his commentary says Madhva is Madhuram. So Madhva basically means sweet. And also he had some sannyas names. His sannyas name is Purna Pragya, and another name is Ananda Tirtha. So these are his two names after sannyas, and the third name is Madhva. So in the Madhva Sampradaya, there is a verse which explains the meaning of the term Madhva. So this is a rare verse, but I have managed to locate and translate it. This is the verse popular in the Madhva Sampradaya, which explains the meaning of the term Madhva. It says, Madhvityananda Uddishto Veti Tirtham Udahritam Madhva Ananda Tirtha Syat Tritiya Maruti Tanuhu. So it is, this verse is giving the explanation of the name Madhva, and it correlates it to his other name Ananda Tirtha also. So let's see how it is. It says Madhu Iti Ananda Uddishto. So Madhu equal to Ananda. Madhu means joy or happiness. And Va Iti Tirtham Udaharitam. And Va means Tirtha. So Madhu equal to Ananda. Va equal to Tirtha. So Madhu and Va become Madhva. And Ananda and Tirtha become Ananda Tirtha. So Madhva Ananda Tirtha Sya Tritiya Maruti Tanu. And he is considered to be the third incarnation of Maruti, that is of Sri Hanuman. So the term Madhu means Ananda. So Madhu equal to Ananda, joy, and the syllable Va means Tirtha, abode. So thus Madhu plus Va becomes Ananda plus Tirtha, that is abode of joy, who is the third incarnation of Hanuman. Now somebody who is a grammarian may say Madhu and Va don't combine to give Madhva. They combine to give Madhuva, not Madhva. So there is a problem in this combination. So it is said in Sanskrit grammar, it is said, you know, Prishodaradini Yathopadishtam. Some words are accepted as they are explained by previous acharyas. So here Madhu plus Va becomes Madhva, because some previous great soul has explained it like this. So that is the explanation behind this. So Madhva is, the meaning of Madhva is Ananda Tirtha, that is abode of joy. So this is the meaning of the name Madhva. So this we have seen. Now we have to come to our main topic, and our main topic today is to explain the philosophical positions taken by Sri Madhvacharya. Now, in order to explain the philosophical positions taken by Sri Madhvacharya, we have to understand that Sri Madhvacharya, he has commented primarily upon the Prasthanatrayi. What is the Prasthanatrayi? Prasthanatrayi means there are three philosophical literatures that Sri Adi Shankaracharya initially commented upon. So we have to first understand what is the meaning of the term Prasthanatrayi. The meaning of the term Prasthana means to go somewhere. To go where? To go on the path of liberation is called as Prasthana. So there are three paths which lead to liberation. What are the three paths which lead to liberation? The first is called as Shruti Prasthan, the path of the Vedas. So if somebody follows the path of the Vedas, especially the Upanishads, so that is called as the Shruti Prasthan, the path of liberation through the direct Vedas. And in this, Sri Adi Shankaracharya commented upon the 10 Upanishads. Isha, Kena, Katha, Prashna, Mundaka, Mandukya, Aitareya, Taittiriya, Brihadaranyaka, Chandogya. Dashopanishad. This is called as Shruti Prasthan. Second is Smriti Prasthan, the path of liberation by hearing the Smritis. So in this, Sri Adi Shankaracharya commented upon Bhagavad Gita. Third is Nyaya Prasthan, path of liberation through logic and argumentation. So this is on this path is Brahma Sutra, and this was also commented upon by Sri Adi Shankaracharya. Now, he commented upon these three prasthanas, and these three prasthanas or these three paths of liberation are called as Prasthanatrayi. Now, his commentary on these three prasthanas, it revolutionized the entire philosophical scene of India, Bharatvarsha, at that point of time, because Bharatvarsha or India at that point of time was overtaken by many other philosophies which were non-Vedic. For example, Bauddha, Jain, Charvak, etc. So many such philosophies had taken over the philosophical scene of Bharatvarsha or India at that point of time. And Sri Adi Shankaracharya, in order to revive Vedic culture, he commented upon and established the superiority of these three prasthan: Shruti Prasthan, Smriti Prasthan, and Nyaya Prasthan. Now, what happened is that actually these three prasthanas, they should be called as Vaishnav prasthanas. Why should they be called as Vaishnav prasthanas? Because these three prasthanas have been composed by Vishnu himself. No, Brahma Sutra has been composed by Vyasadev, who is literally his incarnation of Bhagavan Vishnu. Bhagavad Gita is spoken directly by Bhagavan Krishna. And the Upanishads have come from the breathing of the Purusha. So, all these should actually be known as Vaishnav Prasthan. And it is said in the Bhagavad Gita, Vedaischa Sarvair Aham Eva Vedya. Through all the Vedas, I, Krishna, or I, Vishnu, am to be known. But in the explanation on these Prasthanatrayi, which was given by Adi Shankaracharya, many individuals began to feel that Lord Vishnu has been kept aside and given a secondary position, and impersonal Brahman has been given the primary position. And many individuals, even at the time of Sri Adi Shankaracharya, they were not happy with such a presentation of the Prasthanatrayi. They always felt that in the Prasthanatrayi, Lord Vishnu should be glorified as the Supreme Absolute Truth, not the impersonal Brahman. So, even when Adi Shankaracharya was present on this planet, one time he was visiting a temple, and the pujari of the temple knew that, you know, what is his philosophy. And the pujari of the temple clearly asked him this thing, because this is mentioned in his own biography, Shankar Digvijay. In Shankar Digvijay, it is mentioned, Vijnanavadasya chakim vibhedakam bhavan matam bruhita tah param braja. So the pujari stopped him on the path when Sri Adi Shankaracharya was visiting a temple. The pujari stopped him and said, you want to visit the temple, but first tell me, Vijnanavadasya chakim vibhedakam, what is the difference between your philosophy and the philosophy of the Buddhists? Bhavan matam bruhi, speak, what is the difference? Tatah param braja, then you can go inside. So this is the translation. In the 12th chapter of Shankar Digvijay, verse number 48 says, move ahead only after telling me what difference there is between your philosophy and those of the Vijnanavadis, that is the Shunyavadi Buddhists. So even in the physical presence of Adi Shankaracharya, there were individuals who were very clearly of the opinion that while presenting his commentary on the Prasthanatrayi, many elements of Buddhism have been included, and it does not really represent the complete Vedic opinion of Lord Vishnu being the highest truth in the Vedas. So, therefore, as soon as he wrote his commentary on the Prasthanatrayi, there were always individuals who were dissatisfied. Recently, I saw a video on YouTube in which there is the Shankaracharya of one of the four mathas in India. You know, he is unhappy with our society, ISKCON. And you know, he has made a specific video, and the title of the video is कि इस्कॉन वाले शंकराचार्य को मायावादी क्यों कहते हैं. in Hindi, English it means, why do these ISKCON wallas call Shankaracharya as Mayavadi, as a Mayavadi? So, and then he goes about to speak something negative about, you know, he speaks about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and then he says something negative about the ISKCON devotees. Short and sweet, he doesn't have a very favorable opinion, and he doesn't like it that we call them Mayavadis. So, the fact, however, is that it is not the ISKCON devotees who first, you know, are calling Advaita Vadis as Mayavadis. There are many who before ISKCON, before Madhvacharya also, you know, they were calling the Advaita Vadis as Mayavadis. So, why were they calling them as Mayavadis? This we have to see today. We will see why Adi Shankaracharya's philosophy is termed as Mayavad, that we will also see today. But one thing we should understand is that as far as the personal character of Sri Adi Shankaracharya is concerned, as far as his renunciation is concerned, for that we should have complete respect. So, although we have some severe disagreements with the philosophy of Sri Adi Shankaracharya, that does not result in any sort of dislike of his personal character or his renunciation or his knowledge. So, this is something which we should all try to understand. Now, in Sri Adi Shankaracharya's Sampradaya, we should understand that we have to look at what is Pramana and Prameya. So, what is Pramana and Prameya? What is the main topic to be understood and how to understand it? So, first we should understand what is the meaning of Mana. Mana means the means of understanding or means of measuring something. And Meya means what is the topic to be understood or what is the topic to be measured. We add Pra to both Pramana and Prameya. So, Prameya basically is truth to be understood. So, this is the meaning of the term Prameya. Prameya means what truth should be understood in any Sampradaya. So, if we say in Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya, what is the Prameya? What is the truth to be understood in Sri Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya? So, the truth to be understood in Sri Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya is as follows. In one verse, it has been summarized. What is it? Brahma satyam jagan mithya jivo brahma ivanaparah anena vedyam satchastram iti vedanta dindima. So, according to Sri Adi Shankaracharya's philosophy, Brahma satyam, the impersonal, attributeless, formless Brahman is the only absolute truth. Jagan mithya, the world that we see in front of us, is illusion. On the ultimate paramarthic level, it is an illusion. Jiva Brahma Iva, and Jiva is one with the supreme absolute Brahman, na aparaha, never distinct from it. It is not separate from Brahma. Anena, by these truths, Vedyam Sach Shastram, all bona fide Shastra should be understood. Iti Vedanta Dimdimaha, this is the loud proclamation of Vedanta. So, this is the Prameya, or the topics to be understood in Sri Adi Shankaracharya's Sampradaya. So, this is what they say. Brahma. What is Brahma? Brahma is that which pervades everything. That substance which pervades everything. We cannot see it. We cannot touch it. We cannot feel it. We cannot taste it. We cannot smell it. It is within me. It is within you. It is within everyone. You know, it is everywhere. There is no place where it cannot be. Just like there is water in an ocean, it is present everywhere. It is outside the fishes, water is inside the fishes, everywhere it exists. The fishes do not understand what is water because they are all surrounded by water. Their body is water, everything is water. Similarly, in Adi Shankaracharya's philosophy, this is Brahma. It has no qualities, attributeless, impersonal, all present everywhere, but cannot be experienced by any of the material senses. This is Brahman in Sri Adi Shankaracharya's philosophy. So, if we understand this is the only truth, And Brahman has no shape, no form, no color, no smell, no taste, no touch, no any qualities or attributes. So what? But the world we see around us is having all qualities and attributes, and everything is there here. So what are we seeing in front of us? So all of that is a transformation of Brahman. Maya has covered Brahma, and therefore we are able to see these transformations of Brahman. All the transformations that we see are nothing but Brahma covered by Maya. So that is what is, you know, all these, this is this Jad Jagat is nothing but that. So once the covering of Maya is removed, all shapes, all sizes, all forms, all colors, everything will cease to be. And what will remain is only one. So that is their one tattva. Madhvacharya Sampradaya, two tattvas, Hari and Jiva. But only one tattva in Sri Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya, that is Brahma. So this is the prameya to be understood in Sri Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. Now, there is no mention of Lord Hari or Vishnu or anything in this philosophy as being the Supreme Absolute Truth. The Supreme Absolute Truth is Brahma in Sri Adi Shankaracharya's philosophy. So it is obvious that many philosophers were not very happy with such a presentation of the Vedas. And just after Sri Adi Shankaracharya's time, within a maybe 50 or 100 years, there were objections that were coming. Various personalities started writing their objections against the presentation of Vedanta Sutra. The sharpest and earliest criticism perhaps came from a Tridandi sannyasi named Bhaskaracharya. So Sri Bhaskaracharya, he wrote his commentary on Vedanta Sutras, and in his commentary he very clearly said, ye tu bauddha matavalambino mayavadinah tepyanena nyayena sutrakareṇaiva nirastaveditavya. So in his commentary, Bhaskaracharya's commentary to Vedanta Sutra 2229, he said that those Mayavadis who are clinging to the opinions of the Buddhists are disproved by the logic of the composer of Brahma Sutras, that is Vyasadeva himself. So somebody say, because recently I heard that one of the Shankaracharya is saying, why do the ISKCON devotees call Shankaracharya as Mayavadi? It is not the ISKCON devotees who have started this trend. This trend was started just after a few hundred years after the disappearance of Adi Shankaracharya, and Bhaskaracharya, he was the one perhaps to initially give this term Mayavadi. And where exactly he gave this term, I have given the reference here in his commentary to Vedanta Sutra. So why they are known as Mayavadi, this also we will see. Why not Advaitavadi? Because Advaita means they say there is no difference between Jiva and Brahma. So they should be called as Advaitavadi. But why were they termed as Mayavadi by Bhaskaracharya? This we will have to see, which we will come to later. But it is undoubtedly true that Sri Adi Shankaracharya's writings, they turned the tide of philosophy in India, and Vedic culture was, you know, once again the talk of the entire town because of his presentation of the Prasthanatri. Now, coming to Sri Madhvacharya Sampradaya, Sri Madhvacharya was not at all happy with the presentation of the Prameya or the main topic to be understood. The Prameya presented by Adi Shankaracharya was that Brahma Satya Jagan Mithya. That Brahma is the only truth and the Jagat or the material world is Mithya. The material world is false. So he was not happy with this, because Madhvacharya himself was born in a Shivalli Brahman family. He had studied the Vedas and he knew that, you know, in the Vedas, it is Lord Vishnu who should be glorified. So Sri Madhvacharya, he said that, you know, Prameya means what truth should be understood from the Vedas. So, Sri Madhvacharya gave us nine truths to be understood from the Vedas. So, what are the nine truths? These nine truths are listed by Sri Jayatirtha as well as Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan in our Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya. So, the nine important truths which we should understand, which make us distinct from the philosophy of Sri Adi Shankaracharya, are the nine pramayas of Sri Madhvacharya. So these are summarized in this verse of Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan, which is inspired from a verse of Sri Jayatirtha of the Madhva Sampradaya. So this verse is in the Pramaya Ratnavali. We can find this verse. I will sing this verse. श्रीमन्मध्वमते हरिः परतमः सत्यं जगत्तत्त्वतो भेदो जीवगणा हरेरनुचरा नीचोच्च भावं गता मुक्तिर्नैज सुखानुभूतिरमला भक्तिश्च तत्साधनं यक्षादित्रितयं प्रमाणमखिलां नायैकवेद्यो हरे. So these are the nine pramayas that we should understand. These are the nine important topics to be understood in Sri Madhvacharya's philosophy. In all the Vedic literature, these are the nine main topics that we should understand. What are the nine main topics that we should understand? Shriman Madhvamate, according to Sri Madhvacharya's opinion, Hari Paratama. Hari is the supreme absolute truth of the Vedas. Please try to understand. Not Brahma, but Hari. Lord Vishnu is the supreme absolute entity in all of creation. And Satyam Jagat. And Sri Adi Shankaracharya says Jagan Mithya, but Sri Madhvacharya says Satyam Jagat. Jagat is not Mithya. It is Satya. It is true. What you see in front of your eyes is not simply an illusion, it is not simply a mirage. So it is actually a fact. Tatvata, it is fact from tatva. From a siddhantic perspective, it is the world is true. Bhedo jiva gana. And the jiva gana, there is a bheda, there is a difference between the living entities and Lord Hari. There is an eternal difference. Hare ranuchara. And all the jivas are anuchara, they are servants of Hari. Nicho chabhavam gata. And there is hierarchy, there is gradation in the realizations, levels, happiness experienced by the jivas. Not all jivas are not the same. Muktir naija sukhanubhutir. What is liberation? Liberation is nija sukhanubhuti, the bliss of self-realization. That is mukti. And how to attain that mukti? It says amala bhaktischa tat sadhanam. The only means to attain mukti is to perform bhajan or bhakti of Bhagavan Hari. And how do we know all this? So we know it through pramanas or through the means of knowledge. What are the three pramanas? Yakshaditritayam pramanam. There are three pramanas: pratyaksha pramana, anuman pramana, shabda pramana. These three are the pramanas. And akhilamnayaik vedyo hari. Akhila amnaya. I mean, all the Vedas. Eka vedya. The only person to be understood is Hari. The only personality to be understood in all the Vedas is Lord Hari. By understanding Hari, we will understand Brahma, Paramatma, everybody else. Every other entity will be understood by understanding Hari through the Vedas. So these are the nine pramayas. First is Sriman Madhvamate Hari Paratama. Hari is the Sarvottama, the greatest entity. Satyam Jagat, the world is real. Bheda Jiva Gana, there is a categorical difference between Ishwara, the Lord, and Jiva, the soul. And this is an eternal difference. So this is called as Jiva Esha Bheda. And Hare Ranucharaha, the Jivas are all Hari's followers. They are all servants of Lord Hari by their constitution. And नीचोच्च भावम गता, देर इज हायरार्की, तारतम्य, हायरार्की अमंगस्ट ऑल द लिविंग एंटिटीज, ऑल लिविंग एंटिटीज आर नॉट द सेम. एंड मुक्तिर नैज सुखानुभूति, लिबरेशन इज टू एक्सपीरियंस ब्लिस अकॉर्डिंग टू द कैपेसिटी ऑफ द जीव, यू नो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल ब्लिस अकॉर्डिंग टू द कैपेसिटी ऑफ द जीव. एंड हाउ टू डू दैट, भक्तिश्च तत् साधनम, द मीन्स टू अटेन दैट लिबरेशन इज टू परफॉर्म भक्ति. So bhakti is the only method by which one can attain liberation and especially eternal service to Lord Vishnu. And there are three main pramanas, means of knowledge, pratyaksha, anuman and shabda. Most of us know what are the three pramanas. Pratyaksha means gaining knowledge by direct sense perception. Anuman means logical inference and logical deduction. And shabda is to verbal testimony or authority of Shastra, that is called as Shabda Pramana. And finally, Akhilam Nayai Kavedyo Hari, through all the Vedas only Hari is to be known. So these are the nine Prameyas or nine topics to be understood in the Vedas according to Sri Madhvacharya. So our three-part presentation is dedicated to these nine topics. Today I will be covering only the first topic, that is Hari Sarvottama. Then in the remaining 2 days, we will cover four topics every day. 2, 3, 4, 5 tomorrow and 6, 7, 8, 9 day after tomorrow. So this is how I plan to carry out this particular session, three sessions. So the first topic is Hari Sarvottama. Vishnu is the greatest entity in all of creation. So today we have to focus upon that. So we can see Sri Madhvacharya is holding a deity of Sri Udupi Krishna in his hands. And Sri Madhvacharya very boldly proclaimed that in all the Vedic literature, it is not Brahma which is the supreme truth. So actually it is Bhagavan Vishnu who is the supreme truth. Hari is Sarvottama. The supreme truth is Hari. Because somebody may say, oh, Brahma is Vishnu. You know, Brahman is nothing but Vishnu. But it's a very dangerous statement to make. Why is it a dangerous statement to make? Because in a statement, what are you putting as the subject and what are you putting as the predicate? That is very important. Subject is known as Uddeshya, predicate is known as Vidheya. So what is the subject and predicate? That is very important. If you reverse the subject and predicate, you know, then the entire meaning of the sentence changes. For example, if we say, you know, humans are mammals, you know, so the subject is humans and the predicate is mammals. And if we reverse it, mammals are humans, then the entire meaning changes. So what is the subject and what is the predicate, that should be very carefully noted. So when we say Brahma is Vishnu, so impersonal Brahman is nothing but Vishnu. So that is a dangerous statement. If we say Vishnu is Brahma, that is okay for us. Why? Because Vishnu is given first priority. So that is the statement that we like to make. Vishnu comes out at the top. So the first prameya or the first truth to be understood is Harihi Sarvottamaha. Hari is the topmost entity in all of creations. This truth should be understood by all of us. Harihi Sarvottamaha. So, somebody may ask Sri Madhvacharya that how did you come to this conclusion that Harihi Sarvottamaha, that Hari is the topmost entity in all of creation? Because in the Vedas, there are so many conflicting statements which proclaim many deities to be the supreme. For example, in the Rig Veda, it is said, Hiranyagarbha samavartatagre, 8th mandal, 7th sukta, hymn 3rd, it is said, Hiranyagarbha samavartatagre, agre samavartata, the firstborn personality is Hiranyagarbha, Brahma. So Brahma is the first born personality, says Rig Veda. Okay. Then in the Upanishads, it is said, Eko Rudro na Dvitiyaya. The only controller of this world is Rudra, Bhagavan Shiva. Na Dvitiyaya. It is not controlled by anybody else. So, you know, some parts of the Vedas are proclaiming Brahma to be supreme. Some parts are proclaiming Rudra to be supreme. Then in Rig Veda again it is said, Indro Yato Vasitasya Raja. That of all the living entities who are in this creation, Indra is the Raja, Indra is the king. So in the Vedas, in this way, we will find so many deities to be mentioned, and these deities are conflicting with each other, you know, as to who is the supreme. Somebody may read all of this and say, then who is the supreme? Hiranyagarbha is the supreme, Rudra is the supreme, or Indra is the supreme. And Adi Shankaracharya will say, don't worry, you know, they are all transformations of Brahma. Actually, Brahma is supreme. There is no personality is supreme. Only Brahman is supreme. And Hiranyagarbha, Rudra, Indra, they are nothing but Maya's transformation. So Brahma takes various forms. And Indra is one form, Brahma is one form, Rudra, Shiva is another form. They are all transformations of Maya. The original substance is Brahman. This is what Sri Adi Shankaracharya's philosophy will say. And Sri Madhvacharya, however, you know, points out to a very specific sukta or very specific hymn in the Rig Veda, which is called as Lakshmi Sukta. He says, in the Vedas itself, it can be understood as to who is the supreme. And he points out to this Lakshmi Sukta, in which Lakshmi Devi is saying, Yam kamaye tam tamugram krinomi, tam brahmanam tam rishim sumedha, aham rudraya dhanuratanomi. So Lakshmi Devi says, Yam kamaye tam, if I desire, Lakshmi Devi says, Tam tam ugram pranomi, I make him Rudra, I make him Shiva. Tam brahmanam, and I can make him Brahma. Tam rishim sumedha, make him a very intelligent sage like Brahma. Aham rudraya dhanuratanomi, and it is me, Lakshmi, who has bestowed the dhanu, the bow, pinak, the bow of Shiva unto him. This is given in Lakshmi Sukta of Rig Veda. This is 10th mandal. 125th Sukta, 5th hymn. And Lakshmi Devi then herself says in the immediate preceding verse, preceding hymns, Mama Yoni Rapswanta Samudre. But my birth is from that personality who is within the Samudra, who is within the ocean. So that is, she is referring to Garbhodashai Vishnu. So Sri Madhvacharya says that Lakshmi is above all these personalities, Brahma, Shiva, Indra, etc. And Lakshmi herself says that she is, you know, she is, her source lies in the personality who is within the Garbhodaka ocean. So according to this direct words of the Veda, Sri Madhvacharya proves that Hari hi sarvottamaha, that Hari is the supreme personality. Now, if Sri Adi Shankaracharya is asked that what is your opinion, or what is in your opinion, who is Vishnu? What is the position of Vishnu? Who is Vishnu? So, you know, Sri Adi Shankaracharya's position is clearly defined as follows. Maya avachinnam chaitanyam parameshwarah. In the Vedanta Paribhasha, it is said, Supreme Lord is covered by Maya, that is known as Ishvara Parameshwara. So when Brahma is covered by Maya, he becomes the Supreme Lord Parameshwara. Now, if Brahma becomes covered by Maya, if the impersonal becomes covered by, you know, its own energy and takes a form as Vishnu, then in such a philosophy, who is more powerful, Brahma or Maya? Because द कवरिंग इज मोर पावरफुल देन वॉट इज कवर्ड, देयरफॉर द कवरिंग इज एबल टू कवर इट. सो मैनी इंडिविजुअल्स वेरी क्लियरली आइडेंटिफाइड दैट माया इज बींग गिवन अननेसेसरी पावर इन दिस फिलोसफी. अनदर प्लेस, अनदर फिलोसफी, अनदर बुक ऑफ आदिशंकराचार्य संप्रदाय पंचदशी, इट सेज माया बिंबो वशीकृत्य तम स्यात् सर्वज्ञ ईश्वरः. So he who is Ishwar is a form within the domain of Maya, Maya Bimbaha. And even though he is within Maya, he is able to control that Maya and therefore he is known as Ishwara. So this is Panchadashi, another literature of Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. So very clearly, it is mentioned that Ishwara or Bhagwan is covered by Maya in Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. And, you know, therefore, since he is covered by Maya in Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya, and Maya is given, an ability to cover even Brahma or even Ishwar, therefore Maya is the supreme entity in this philosophy. Therefore, many people started calling it Mayavad, the philosophy in which Maya is the supreme. Because if Maya is covering even the Supreme Lord, then it should be called Mayavad. That is what it should be called. Now, Sri Madhvacharya came and directly spoke against this. Sri Madhvacharya says, Panchabhutatmakam deho Vishnuh pashyantya yoginah tathana yogi radhanto jnanam deho hareriti. Now, Madhvacharya is not simply, doesn't want to simply argue against Adi Shankaracharya, but he finds it very inconsistent to say that, you know, what Adi Shankaracharya said previously. Let's see this. Supreme Lord is covered by Maya. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna himself says, Ye mam prapadyante maya metam tarantite. Those who surrender unto me, they cross over Maya. You know, so if they surrender to Krishna, they can cross over Maya. But if Sri Adi Shankaracharya says that Krishna himself is a form covered by Maya, then how can Krishna help somebody else in crossing over Maya? So first Krishna should cross over Maya in such a philosophy. So therefore, in this philosophy becomes inconsistent with many of the words of Bhagavan himself. You know, Maya adhyakshena prakriti suyate sacharacharam. So in Bhagavad Gita it is said, she is under my guidance. Maya adhyakshena prakriti. Maya is under my guidance. So many such statements are there by the Lord himself, which clearly prove that the Lord is never covered by Maya. Lord is in fact the controller of Maya. But in Adi Shankaracharya's philosophy, it is very clearly said, Maya avachinnam chaitanyam parameshwara. Supreme Lord is covered by Maya. Now, if Supreme Lord is covered by Maya, then his body will be made out of Maya. Then his form is made out of Maya. Then his qualities are made out of Maya. They agree, yes, it is all made out of Maya. And you know, which means Krishna's name, form, qualities are all temporary and subject to destruction. So this is the implication of accepting Mayavad. That Krishna's name, Krishna's form, Krishna's qualities, Krishna's pastimes become temporary products of Maya. And ultimate truth remains only impersonal Brahman. So, actually, any form of any entity is Maya. That is what they will say. So, Sri Madhvacharya very clearly said, Panchabhutatmakam deho Vishnu pashyanti ayoginah. Tathana yogi radhanto jnanam deho hareriti. Sri Madhvacharya in his Bhagavat Tatpare Hiranai very clearly said, ignorant non-yogis, so he is using a very strong word, ignorant non-yogis, ayoginaha, think of the body of Lord Vishnu as made out of panchabhuta, as made out of five material elements. Tathana yogi radhanto, yogi is aware of the true conclusions, don't see like this. How do they see his body? Jnanam deho hareriti. They see his body as composed of true eternal knowledge. Lord Krishna's body, Lord Vishnu's body, they are composed Satchidananda Vigraha. This is the truth of Bhagwan Vishnu's existence. Because if we say that Vishnu himself is covered by Maya, then Vishnu's body will be made out of Maya. Then it means just like we are getting a body out of Maya, then Vishnu has also gotten a similar body made out of Maya. And if Vishnu has also gotten a similar body made out of Maya, then Vishnu will also become subject to the unhappiness and happiness of the material world. Whereas the fact is that there is no, you know, material happiness or material distress which can ever at any point of time touch Lord Vishnu. There are so many statements in the Bhagavad Gita, you know, which say, which proclaim the glory of, you know, Lord Vishnu. You know, it is said in the Bhagavad Gita, I am reading a few statements. Aham Krishnasya Jagataha Prabhavaha Pralayastatha. You know, I am the creator, destroyer of the universe. Mattaha Parataram Nanyam Nanyat Kinchid Asti Dhananjaya. There is no truth higher than me. द्वाविमाव पुरुषाव लोके क्षरस चाक्षर एवच शरह सर्वाणी भूतानि कूटस्थो अक्षर उच्यते. I am the अक्षर पुरुष in this universe. So, and he also says अतोस्मि लोके वेदे च प्रथितः पुरुषोत्तम. I am the greatest पुरुष in this entire world, as also proclaimed in the Vedas. नमे पार्थास्ति कर्तव्यं त्रिषु लोकेषु किंचन. Krishna says there is no duty for me in all these three worlds. Bhagavad Gita 10.8, he says, Mattaha Sarvam Pravartate, everything comes from me. Then he 10.2, he says, Aham Adirhi Devanam Maharshinam Cha Sarvashah. I am the beginning of all the gods, of all the sages. Maya Dhyakshana Prakriti Suyate Saracharacharam. Mahi Sarvamidam Protam Sutra Manigana Iva. So then in 9th chapter, Krishna says, Sarva Bhutani Kauntaya Prakritim Yanti Mamikam. So all the living entities, you know, they are belonging to my Prakriti. So all the living entities are being controlled by me. Mameva ye prapandyante maya metam tarantite. 7.14 he says, those who surrender unto me, they cross over maya. So Veda ischa sarvai raham eva vedya. This is so many pramanas given by Bhagavan Krishna himself in Bhagavad Gita. So many pramanas. And so many pramanas are there. How can somebody think of Lord Hari as being a product of Maya? He is not like a Jiva, he is not covered by Maya. So therefore, Mayavad is something which is of serious concern to Vaishnavas. Very serious concern. So we have immense respect for the personal character, for the renunciation, for all the good qualities that Sri Adi Shankaracharya displayed. But as far as the philosophy or explanation of the Prasthanatrayi is concerned, we have very serious reservations about it. So it doesn't match what Krishna has said in the Bhagavad Gita. Doesn't match. And you know, when this Mayavad is applied to Vishnu, that Vishnu is nothing but a temporary form. Brahma, you know, it gets covered by Maya, becomes Vishnu, Krishna, Ram, Parshuram, Balaram, takes so many forms. Then it goes on extending. Then, you know, that Brahma is also Ganesh. That Brahma is also Shiv. That Brahma is also Devi. That Brahma is also Surya. So you can worship any of the Panchadevatas. You can worship Surya also and then attain Brahma. Then you can worship Devi and attain Brahma. You can worship Shiva and attain Brahma. You can worship Vishnu and attain Brahma. You can worship Ganesh and attain Brahma. You can worship any deity and attain Brahma. And then gradually this goes on deteriorating. So recently then it deteriorates into the what we see recently, that anybody proclaims to be Bhagwan, that today I am Bhagwan. Somebody starts saying, and you are, if you ask them, how are you Bhagwan? It's because I am Brahma. If I am Bhagwan. So this is how the gradual degradation takes place of any system of religiosity. So Sri Madhvacharya, he wanted to prevent such a misunderstanding, and in strong words he said that anybody who sees Lord Vishnu's body as made out of five material elements is a yogi. A yogi means that person does not understand what is the truth. Actual yogis are aware of the fact that Krishna's body is Sachidananda, Vigraha. So this is the conclusion. Then other Vaishnava Acharyas also had Previous to Madhvacharya also, Vaishnava Acharyas had given the same conclusion. For example, Sri Ramanujacharya, in the Sri Bhashya, he had very clearly said in the Jigyasa Adhikaran, in the very first sutra, Sri Ramanujacharya said, Brahma Shabdena. You know, whenever we use the term Brahma, impersonal Brahma, 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 whatever we say Brahma, so we should not call it impersonal. What is Brahman? He said, Brahma Shabdena Swabhavato Nirasta Nikhila Dosho Anavadika Atishaya Asankhyaya Kalyana Gunagana Purushottamo Vidhiyate. So, Ramanujacharya says, by the term Brahman, Supreme Lord Vishnu, you know, Purushottam Vishnu is denoted. And what is that Vishnu? Swabhavato Nirasta Nikhila Dosha is faultless by his very nature and eternally equipped with unlimited auspicious transcendental qualities. Atishaya, Asankhyaya, Kalyana, Gunagana. So that is Brahman. Don't call Brahman as that impersonal, you know, fluid which is everywhere in the universe and nobody can see it or touch it or taste it or smell it. That is not Brahma. Brahma indicates Vishnu. That very clear opinion of Sri Ramanujacharya in his Sri Bhashyam introduction. So, other Vaishnava Acharyas also are exactly on the same page as Sri Madhvacharya when it comes to proclaiming the superiority of Hari. So many times, you know, in the Sri Sampradaya, whenever they begin recitation of a Vedic mantra, they will begin with Harihi Om. So, they always begin with Harihi Om, not simply Om. So, Harihi Om means actually Hari is the supreme absolute truth in the Vedas. Always a reminder, Harihi Om. So, Hari is the personality denoted by the term Om. So, that is something which Vaishnava Acharyas have very clearly proclaimed. Now, Sri Vallabhacharya also in the western side of India, Sri Vallabhacharya also very clearly accepted this conclusion. Sri Vallabhacharya in his Anubhashya, he says, Janita paramam tattvam yashodot sangalalitam tadanyam idiye prahur asuram stana ho buddha. Very strong words. Sri Vallabhacharya said, Aho buddha, O intelligent souls, Janita, understand, paramam tattva, the supreme truth, to be Yashodot Sangalalitam, to be the one who is being nourished in the lap of Yashoda. Understand Krishna as the absolute truth. Krishna comes above Brahma. Krishna is the resting place of Brahman. It's not that Brahman is the resting place of Vishnu or Hari or Krishna. Krishna is the resting place of all other tattvas. Tadanyam iti ye prahur, you know, those who speak otherwise, asuram stan, so janita, so understood them, understand them to be asuras, or you know, understand them to be demons. Basically, is using a very strong word here, Sri Vallabhacharya in his Anubhashya on Vedanta Sutra. Now, Sri Nimbarkacharya in his writings also, he also has very clearly spoken of this. So, Sri Nimbarkacharya in his commentary also, he has spoken of this. And what does Sri Nimbarkacharya says? Sri Nimbarkacharya says, Svabhavato upasta samasta dosham ashesha kalyana gunaika rashim yuhanginam brahma param varenyam dhyayema krishnam kamalekshanam harim. Same conclusion. Svabhavatopasta samasta dosham ashesha kalyana gunaika rashim vyuhanginam brahma param varenyam dhyayema krishnam kamalekshanam harim. So dhyayema, we meditate on kamalekshanam krishnam harim, lotus eyed Krishna, who is svabhavatopasta samasta dosham, who by his very svabhav, by his very nature, free of all faults. And ashesha kalyana gunaika rashim, an eternal personality having unlimited auspicious qualities. Vyuhanginam brahma param varenyam, supreme Brahman. You know, so that is our Lord Krishna. So Sri Nimbarkacharya's commentary to Brahma Sutra, he has very clearly mentioned this thing. So all the Vaishnava Acharyas have given this conclusion that Sri Harihi इज सर्वोत्तमः, दैट हरि इज द सुप्रीम पर्सनैलिटी ऑफ गॉड हेड. ही इज द पर्सनैलिटी हु शुड बी अंडरस्टूड फ्रॉम ऑल द वेदर्स. इफ यू स्पेंड योर एंटायर लाइफ इन अंडरस्टैंडिंग ब्रह्म, देन देर इज नो स्पेसिफिक पर्सनैलिटी दैट वी विल गेट अटैच टू. And then we will see all personalities as creations of Maya. And then if we start seeing also Lord Krishna as Maya, made out of Maya, then we have, you know, surrendered ourselves to the philosophy known as Mayavad. So we don't want to surrender ourselves to that philosophy. Lord Hari's body is Satchidananda. Our philosophy, what do the Gaudiya Vaishnavas think? We are straight in line with Madhvacharya. Ishvaraha Paramaha Krishna. Very simple. In Brahma Samhita, there is very clearly proclaimed Ishvaraha Paramaha Krishna. That the Supreme Lord is who? Krishna. That is, and Satchidananda Vigraha. Immediately disproving Mayavad philosophy. What is his body made out of? Satchidananda Vigraha. Anadir Adir Govindaha Sarva Karana Karanam. Cause of all causes. He is not caused by Brahman. He is the cause of Brahman. So he is the one on whom Brahman is resting. It is not that Krishna's form is resting upon the impersonal Brahman. So this is Ishvara Parama Krishna Satchidananda Vigraha Anadir Adir Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam. This is our philosophical position, which proclaims that Harihi Sarvottamaha. Hari is the Sarvottama, the supreme personality in all the Vedas. So this is the first Prameya, dear devotees, to be understood. Now, many places in the Upanishads, it is said that Brahma has no qualities. A Shabda, A Sparsha, A Rupa, you know, no quality, no form, no sound, no taste, no touch. And in some other places in the Upanishads, it is said, Sarva Rasa, Sarva Gandha, Sarvanama, he has all qualities, he has all names, he has all forms. So in the Vedanta Sutra, Sri Adi Shankaracharya takes both these positions and he says actually only one of them should be accepted, that the impersonal Brahman has no form, no qualities, no nothing. All form, all qualities are nothing but a covering of Maya. But the Vaishnavas say that whenever the Vedic scriptures are saying that the Brahman has no form, no qualities, you know, it is referring to material form or material qualities. And whenever the scriptures say that the Lord has all forms, all qualities, it means he has all unlimited auspicious spiritual forms, unlimited auspicious spiritual qualities. So this is the explanation of the Vaishnava Acharyas. So this, dear devotees, is our first Prameya that I tried to explain today. So, you know, thank you very much, dear devotees. This is the first part of the presentation. Now I'll give some space for some discussion and question and answers. And first Prameya has been understood that in all the Vedas, the supreme entity is Lord Hari, not Brahman, not impersonal Brahman. This is our first philosophical pillar which stands against the philosophy of Vivartavad, Advaitavad, Mayavad. So that is the first Prameya that was explained today in the words of Sri Madhvacharya and the other Vaishnava Acharyas. So thank you very much, dear devotees. Yadatra skalitam kinchit vidvam sahapurayantu tat. Yadatra saushtavam kinchit tad guru reva menahi. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Thank you, Prabhuji. It was really amazing. So beautifully explained, in fact. We are so much impressed by your vast learning, that not just the Vaishnava text, but also other texts. And from that, you are explaining that how Vaishnava Siddhant is so bona fide and in such a beautiful way, in such a simple language, Prabhuji. I would say even most dumb person can understand the subtleties of philosophy if he gets to hear from your glorious mouth. It was really super, Prabhuji. Wonderful, wonderful. And such beautiful slides, such crystal clear information. And it was really wonderful, Prabhuji. Absolutely transforming.
Thank you.
So I would request devotees, in case they want to ask any question, they can raise their hand, and then Jayadwar Kapu can let the devotees speak and ask question from Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhuji, I can ask.
Okay, auspicious start.
Yes, in case, Raji, actually, I have a series of questions, but I will take, I will just ask one or two.
So, I think.
Yes, Raji.
Yeah. So. Yeah, Jai Dwarka Prabhu.
Yes. Yes, Toji.
Yeah. So.
Yes.
Yeah, please.
Toji. Many times this contradiction is raised that the term Mayavad, which we take from Padma Purana as well, and there is a verse where it is told that this philosophy is told as Mayavad. So, Prabhuji, do they accept that, and they challenge the authenticity of this verse actually? Anything about
they challenge that? The authenticity of the verse that is Mayavadam Asat Shastram. That is the verse that you are speaking about. Am I correct, Prabhu?
Yes, Prabhu.
So, you know, the only thing that can be done is, you know, what they say is that this verse doesn't, some people say that this verse doesn't exist in the editions of the Puranas that have been printed. Some individuals say. So, I did some research about this a few years ago, that whether such a verse actually exists in the Puranas or doesn't exist in the Puranas. So when I did my research on this, whether such a verse exists in the Puranas or doesn't exist in the Puranas, so then I found out that there is actually such a verse in the Puranas. So I would like to show this verse to all of you. And those who can read Devanagari. Jai Dwarka Prabhu, you can read Devanagari, Prabhuji?
Yes, yes, Prabhuji, I can read.
So, what I am showing is, this is from Venkateshwar Steam Press, Padma Puran Uttarakhand, Chapter 236. Padma Puran Uttarakhand, Chapter 236. This was not printed by ISKCON. This was printed by Venkateshwar Steam Press. Prabhuji, it is in front of you. Prabhu, can you read the highlighted portion?
Yes, Prabhuji. Yes, Prabhuji, it's there.
What is written there, Prabhu?
Just a minute, Prabhuji. Maya Vadam Acha Shastram.
Prachannam
Bodham Uchyate. Then.
Mayaiva Kathyate Devi Kalau Brahmana Rupina.
Yes, yes, Prabhuji.
So it's there in the, this is in, you can see here at the right, it's a Uttarakhand of Padma Puran, Adhyay 236, 236 yes, chapter, verse number 6 and 7 it is given. So yes. Now.
Yes, yes. Okay, Pooja.
So it, now somebody may say this is interpolated. Somebody has added this. You know, it is not actually spoken by Lord Shiva. So, you know, if they want to say that it is an interpolation, then other personalities also, like Bhaskaracharya around the 10th century has also quoted this verse, Maya Vadam Asat Shastram. So in 10th century, how can it become interpolated? So it's a difficult thing to, you know, it's, and this is where it gets, the debate gets intense. So that is why, you know, at least I saved the Pramana and the printing press from which it was printed, so that nobody has a doubt that, you know, the Mayavad is not some term which we invented. It was there in the Puranas. We used it as we found in the Puranas.
So, Pooji, is there any document for the Bhaskaracharya's version which you are telling?
Yes, yes, there is Bhaskaracharya's commentary on the Vedanta Sutra. So there is. I will show you. An edition of Bhaskaracharya's commentary. You can see here, and it was published. I have shared my screen again.
Yes, Puji.
Brahma Sutra Bhashyam Shri Bhaskaracharya Virachitam. So this is, you know, Brahma Sutra commentary by Bhaskaracharya.
And he was also a Vaishnav?
Yeah, Yatri Dandi. And he was the one who originally, you know, you can see here, he has criticized Adi Shankaracharya's position. So he says sutra abhipraya samvritya swabhipraya prakashanat. Under the disguise of commenting upon the sutras, somebody has given his own explanation. So vyakhyatam yairidam shastram vyakhyayam tan nivritte. So for disproving their philosophy, I am again commenting upon the Brahma Sutras. This is very clearly Bhaskaracharya was against the philosophical position taken by Sri Yadi Shankaracharya. So this was published in 1915 in Banaras from Chaukamba. Brahma Sutra Bhashyam Bhaskaracharya Virichitam.
Okay. So just one more question I'll ask, then I'll hand over to any other devotees. In case in future you allow further after that, then
yes.
I'll ask.
Yes.
So Prabhuji, do these people overtly reject all the Puranas? And what are their conception about Srimad Bhagavatam?
No, they don't reject. See, they are Vedic people. They are in general, they are, you know, Vedic. They are very pious Vedic people. But they have philosophically accepted the position that all forms of the Lord are basically covered by Maya. That is the position that they have accepted. And then any statement in the Puranas which or Upanishads which goes against that understanding, either they try to reinterpret it, or sometimes some statements cannot be reinterpreted, like Maya Vadam Asat Shastram. So they just reject. They say that, you know, we don't accept it. So our thing is, we Vaishnavas, see, because this Madhvacharya and Adi Shankaracharya, this debate has been going from centuries. Centuries it has been going on. There was one personality in the Madhva Sampradaya. He wrote a literature called as Nyayamrita. Nyayamrita, he basically demolished all the philosophical positions of Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. You know, all the philosophical positions of Advaitavad, all the main positions he demolished. And then Madhusudan Saraswati in Varanasi, he wrote a refutation of that called as Advaita Siddhi. Then somebody wrote a refutation of Advaita Siddhi. And somebody wrote a refutation of that. And somebody wrote a refutation of that. And it's still continuing till today. So, so that is what is happening. And, you know, somebody says Advaita Siddhi, Kantakodhar, matlab, removing the thorns in Advaita Siddhi or something like that. What would this is? Then the tikas, the names of the tikas are becoming bigger and more flowery. Or so, should I say more thorny? The names of the tikamentaries are becoming more thorny. So when Mahaprabhu visited these Tattvavadis, Madhvacharya Sampradaya, it's very clearly mentioned in Chaitanya Charitamrita that they are very much attached to tarka, that is argumentation. And then Mahaprabhu made a very remarkable statement about this. What is the statement that Mahaprabhu made about Sri Madhvacharya Sampradaya? So Mahaprabhu's statement about Sri Madhvacharya Sampradaya is also very important, because it is something which is which all of us should be very aware of. And I am sharing this screen, which Mahaprabhu's statement about Madhva Sampradaya, you can see. So Mahaprabhu says, Madhya 9.277, sabe eka guna dekhi tomar sampradaya satya vigraha kari ishwari karaha nishchay. This is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's statement about Madhva Sampradaya. He says, only qualification I see in your sampradaya is that you accept the form of the Lord as truth. Otherwise, by that time, the sampradaya of Madhva Sampradaya was very much into logic and argumentation. Had gone very deep into logic and argumentation. Mahaprabhu did not really very much appreciate the level of logic and argumentation that had, you know, become in the sampradaya at that point of time. So Chaitanya Charitamrita very clearly mentions also that, you know, they were very dedicated to Madhva, they were very dedicated to logic and argumentation. And the Tattvavadi Acharyas were very dedicated to argumentation. But where is bhakti in all of this? So if everything is only whether Brahma is personal or impersonal, if our life is spent in that, then where is the abhidheya? You know, abhidheya should be bhakti. So this we should understand. So I hope.
Thank you, Ruji. And what about Srimad Bhagavatam?
Srimad Bhagavatam, for them it is Purana. Purana means Stri Shudra, द्विजबंधूनां त्रयीण श्रुति गोचर दैट यू नो स्त्री फॉर लेडी शूद्रस दोज हु कैनॉट अटेन बाय दोज हु कैनॉट अंडरस्टैंड ब्रह्म सूत्र फॉर देम देर इज भागवतम फॉर द लोअर कैटेगरी ऑफ पीपल दैट इज देयर ओपिनियन सो दैट इज वॉट यू नो दे आर थिंकिंग अबाउट श्रीमद भागवतम एंड अदर पुराणस ऑल्सो एंड दे मे नॉट डिरेक्टली से इट ऑलवेज बट दिस इज द ऑनेस्ट ओपिनियन बिकॉज इफ यू आस्क देम कैन एवरीबडी रीड ब्रह्म सूत्र Vedant Sutra, they will say no. Only the twice born, especially Brahmanas, can have access to it. Can the Shudras and ladies hear it? No. Can a Vaishnav who is born in a Shudra family read it? No. Can a Vaishnav who is born in a Shudra family, you know, have adhikar for these things, for sannyas, for reading these Brahma Sutras? No. Then what, can they read Srimad Bhagavatam? If a Vaishnava is born in a Shudra family, can he read Srimad Bhagavatam? No, they can hear Srimad Bhagavatam. They cannot read themselves. They don't have the adhikar to read it. So this is the explanation. This is the official explanation that you will get from them.
Okay. Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Prabhuji, can I ask a question, Prabhuji?
Yes.
Prabhuji, we have heard that Yajna Murthy was a great scholar who debated with Sripada Ramacharya for 17 days. From sunrise till sunset. So even though we see that the sutras which I mentioned, the shlokas are so crystal clear that how there is no mayavad in the shastras. But how come he could stand before Sripada Ramanacharya for 17 days, where Sripada Ramanacharya is also known as who refuted 500 pandits together because he debated with them like Ananta Shesh with 500 mouths and he defeated all of them. Somewhere it is mentioned 2000. But how come Yajna Murthy could stand for 17 days in his debate with Sripada Ramanacharya?
Yeah, so how can philosophers defend anything, you know, for so many days? How can non-Vedic philosophies like Buddhism survive for centuries? When Vedic truth, Vedic philosophers are present, bigger question is, how did Buddhism survive for so many centuries when Vedic philosophy, Upanishads, Brahma Sutras are present? So, there is a Sanskrit grammarian and very big authority on Shastra. His name is Bhartrihari. So Bhartrihari, you know, he has made a statement which Rupa Goswami likes very much. You know, Rupa Goswami quotes Bhartrihari's statement in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. I am sharing that statement with him. So this is 1146 Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu in front of us. Rupa Goswami says, Tatra Prachinair Api Uktam. Even the previous authorities, who is that Bhartrihari also says, what does he say? Yatnena apaditopi arthaha. Yatnena. Hindi mein bolenge bahut yata jatan karke, with great effort. Apaditopi artha. Any philosophy that you put. Kushalair anumatribihi. With a very, you may be very expert philosopher. But abhiyukta tarair anyair. But if somebody is even slightly more expert, anyathai vopapadyate. Then they can turn your philosophy against you and, you know, defeat your position. Then you again gain one edge over them. Then you again turn back them. Then they gain an edge above you. Then they turn back upon you. So this keeps happening. And in the case of Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya and Madhvacharya Sampradaya, this is happening till today. So I have been told that in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, sometimes they put an ad in the newspaper. Sometimes some people from the Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya will put an ad in the newspaper that there is a Vidvat Goshti, there is a debate organized. Whoever can defeat Adi Shankaracharya's Siddhantas will get 1 lakh rupees. Anyone is invited. So, you know, and then Vidvat Goshti happens and maybe nobody goes from the Madhva Sampradaya. Then next day the Madhva Sampradaya will put an ad in the paper. There is a Vidvat Goshti from the Madhva Sampradaya organized. Anybody who can defeat the position of Madhvacharya will be given 2 lakh rupees. And so, they are invited. So, you know, in a majority, it's very difficult to prove anything when most of the people are supporting one position. You know, it's one thing if somebody from Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya comes to an ISKCON temple and, you know, tries to say, now I will prove. So, you can be 100% sure that he will not be able to prove. But if an ISKCON devotee goes to an Adi Shankaracharya's mutt and says, now I will prove all of, you know, then you can be 100% sure that he also will not be successful. Because wherever there is majority, it is not possible to prove these things. But Sri Ramanujacharya in a neutral environment proved it. So it took him so many days. So it was not, sometimes we can't prove to something by defeating somebody. We have to convince somebody. It took time for Ramanujacharya to convince that person, because we can't defeat somebody. When we say that we have defeated somebody, it means we have rubbed humiliation on their face. And in that way, they will never be convinced. The only way to truly defeat somebody is to convince them, you know, of these positions. So that is the reason why it took so many, because genuine philosophical discussions, they take so much time. That is the answer to your query, Prabhu.
Thank you, Prabhu. And Prabhu, we see that our philosophy is quite close to Nimbarkacharya philosophy, where we have taken the two tenets, Radhika Sharanam, and then the Gopi Bhav. But Mahaprabhu chose Madhvacharya Sampradaya, where there was more bold philosophy and Mayavad Khandan. So why he did not choose to appear in Nimbarkacharya Sampradaya, which is quite closer to our philosophy in terms of esoteric aspect of our philosophy?
Right.
Why he chose Madhvacharya Sampradaya?
Right. The thing is, when it comes to Bhagavat Tattva, Tattva of Bhagavan, that the foundations above which we will place bhakti, the foundation is Bhagavat Tattva, Brahma Tattva, Bhagavat Tattva. In case of that, Madhvacharya's Siddhantas are very pakka. That, you know, if you ask Sri Ramanujacharya that who is Vishnu, what is the supreme truth? So he will say there is Chit, spiritual, Achit, material, and Vishnu is Vishesh. He is separate from both these. So it is called as Vishishtadvaita. He is separate from Chit and Achit. So there is matter, there is Brahman, and Vishnu is separate from matter and Brahman, because Vishnu has many infinite qualities. So, and if you ask Sri Ramanujacharya who created this material world, he will say Brahma created this material world. But Madhvacharya will say Hari created. Krishna is the Karta. Matlab, he is very specific that the personality is the doer. So when it comes to the foundations, the basis of our philosophical positions, those cannot be chosen on the basis of whom we worship. Those have to be chosen in regards to who is very clearly representing the opinions of the Vedas in the best way. That is, you know, Sri Madhvacharya's position is the best in that regard. Now, when it comes to the details, for example, when we build a building, so we want to select the cement which will give the strongest foundation. What coloring and painting and what paintings we'll put on the wall, that's a different issue. But our foundation should be, our cement should be that which will keep our entire structure solid for a long duration, for eternity, to say. This is the reason why Madhvacharya's philosophical foundations are very solidly grounded and very clear that Hari is the doer, Hari is the karta. Naham karta, Hari reva karta. I am not the doer, Hari is the doer of all the activities. Not Brahma. Brahma cannot do anything. How can Brahma? Brahma has no qualities, no attributes. How can Brahma become the doer of anything? Madhvacharya very clear. Hari is the doer of everything. So this philosophically, we are closest to this when it comes to Bhagavat Tattva. Now, when it comes to Bhakti Tattva, Prem Tattva, so we find some alignment with Sri Nimbarka Sampradaya. That is okay. But when it comes to our roots, our Tattva in this world, our alignment is with Sri Madhvacharya Sampradaya. That is the answer to your query.
Like we see in Madhva Sampradaya, even they call Lakshmi as Jiva, who is very special Jiva, although but they, even Lakshmi is Jiva, but we call Lakshmi as expansion of internal potency. Right. But such quite different positions are there, but yet Mahaprabhu has chosen so. But in case we see the Nimbarka Sampradaya, they actually, Shrimati Radhika and the Gopis, they are considered as part of internal potency. So there it seems that even philosophically we are near to Nimbarka Charya Sampradaya more. But if I
show you an author from Madhva Sampradaya who glorifies Radharani, how will that be? So there are individuals in the Madhva Sampradaya who accept and glorify Srimati Radharani. One such personality from the Madhva Sampradaya, his name is Sri Vanamali Mishra. Vanamali Mishra was a personality from Madhva Sampradaya who stayed in Vrindavan. So he's a very special personality, Vanamali Mishra, who stayed in Vrindavan, but he is from the Madhva Sampradaya. He wrote his commentary on the Bhagavad Gita. And in his commentary on the Bhagavad Gita, in the 12th chapter, when he begins the 12th chapter, at that point of time, he glorified Srimati Radharani. So I am directly sharing that screen, a personality from the Madhva Sampradaya. The Madhvacharya personalities accept him. This is 12th chapter Bhakti Yoga. You can see in front of your screen, Prabhu. So this is commentary of Sri Vanamali Mishra. And I am, see, Prabhu, I am highlighting in front of you this verse. Shri Sachidananda Ghanam Anantadbhuta Vaibhavam Kridantam Radhaya Sardham Vande Shri Nanda Nandanam. So, Kridantam Radhaya Sardham is playing, sporting with Shri Radha. Vande Shri Nanda Nandanam. My obeisances to Shri Nanda Nandana. Who is this commentary? Who is the commentator? Name of the commentary is Shri Vanamali Mishra Virachita Gita Gudartha Chandrika. This is Vanamali Mishra's commentary on Bhagavad Gita. Who was it printed? It was printed by Satya Tirtha Pratishthanam, by a Madhva Pratishthan. So it was printed by, you know, a Madhva publication house. In the 12th chapter introduction itself, Srimati Radharani is glorified. So we can't say that they don't glorify Radharani, but it's not as prominent as the Nimbarka Sampradaya's glorification of Srimati Radharani.
Yeah, right. You see that in Madhvacharya Sampradaya, we get very strong foundation. Right. But Nimbarka is giving foundation as well as some aspect of building as well.
Right. So that's Yeah, we want our interiors to be close to Nimbarka Sampradaya, but our foundations to be closer from to Madhva Sampradaya. So, but we say that because the Sampradaya is understood from its foundations. So, foundation wise, we are a Shakha Bhed. So, somebody may ask, how are you allowed to have a difference? We are allowed to have, just as there is a Ramanandi Sampradaya, it is a Shakha Bhed of Shri Sampradaya. Now, if you ask Ramanandi Sampradaya, who is the supreme personality, they will say Lord Ram. If you ask Shri Sampradaya, who is the supreme, they will say Lord Narayan. So there is a Shakha Bhed here. So Shakha Bhed is technically allowed, just as Ramanandis are allowed to have a Shakha Bhed with Shri Sampradaya. So similarly, the Gaudiyas are also allowed to have some Shakha Bhed, some small details are, you know, we can have different, but doesn't mean that our trunk is missing. Our trunk is still Madhva Sampradaya. That we should understand. That we should be very clear with.
Okay. Any other devotee wants to ask question? Okay, Prabhuji, in Zoom chat,
there's one. Shivam Prabhu is waiting for you.
Okay, Shivam Prabhu, you may ask. Okay, all right.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
No. Questions, Prabhuji. First, Prabhuji, we come to know about the four Sampradayas mentioned in scriptures, but then you again talked about the Shaka Sampradayas. And there are several Shaka Sampradayas in Vrindavan and outside. So how can we know if Shaka Sampradayas are genuine or not?
Yeah. We can understand the Shaka Sampradaya is genuine if in its Sampradayic lineage there is a connection to a Mukhya Sampradaya. So if the in our lineage, our connection, Srila Kavi Karnapur in Gaur Ganodesh Tipika has given a direct connection to Madhvacharya. So since we are connected to the Mukhya Sampradaya, therefore any Shakha Sampradaya which is connected to one of the four Mukhya Sampradayas is bona fide. That is the answer.
So, Prabhuji, that will lead to possibilities of deviations in philosophy, that some personality will come in and start a Shakha Sampradaya with his own set of philosophy.
Yeah.
And this can be harmful.
That is always possible, and it happened also. In Gaudiya Vaishnava, there was a whole wave of Sahajayism. So, you know, they also call themselves followers of Mahaprabhu. They are also Shakha Bhed. So any system of religion is prone to degradation over a period of time, and therefore we need time to time purification by personalities who are empowered to do such purification. That's all. So it's not material world means, even Lord Krishna said that, you know, I spoke this to Vivaswan, Sa Kaleneha Mahata. So even Lord Krishna said, I spoke to the sun god and the knowledge was lost. What to do? I have to revive it again. So similarly, in Shakas also, it can happen that original knowledge can get covered. So what we can do is, as Gaudiya Vaishnavas, is stick to Rupa Goswami. As long as you're sticking to Rupa Goswami, we are all right, perfect. No problem at all.
Prabhuji, one question has come from... He says that, will we accept Swami Narayan Sampradaya as Shakha Sampradaya of Ramanujacharya, because they say that we are Ramanandis and they also claim to have Vishishta Dvaitvad as their philosophy?
Yeah, yeah. Anyone, if they have a genuine connection to any of the four Vaishnava Sampradaya, so according to the Sampradaya connection, they are bona fide. But then we should also see whether each of the main philosophical tenets are the same as the original Sampradaya. That also we have to see. That I have not investigated as far as Swaminarayan Sampradaya is concerned. But what I have been told is that they consider themselves to be a shakha of the Ramanandi Sampradaya, Sri Sampradaya basically. So if the shakha is there, then no problem at all, because the very acknowledgement that we are a shakha, it gives they are saying that we are agreeing to a Vaishnava Sampradaya, which gives bona fideness. But if there is something in them, we should check each and every philosophical tenet before giving a final conclusion about a Sampradaya. So that is what I would like to say in this regard.
Yes, Toji, another devotee with the name Abhinandan Nitai Prabhu is there waiting for questions.
Yes, yes.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, thank you for the wonderful presentation. Prabhuji, my question is, when you presented so many proofs from Bhagavad Gita is so clearly disproving Mayavad, then how was Adi Shankaracharya so successful in spreading his philosophy and convincing everyone about his philosophy? Because Bhagavad Gita has existed since such a long period of time.
So Bhagavad Gita has existed even before Sri Adi Shankaracharya. And how was he able to prove to so many individuals? Because one thing we have to understand, that he was able to prove that because he was speaking about the supremacy of Brahman. And in many places in the Bhagavad Gita, Brahma is also, you know, spoken of in very high terms. But his glorification of Brahma, his description of Brahma was so much that Brahma came out on top and the personalities became subordinate to Brahma. And because of his use of Nyaya, Tarka, the Pramanas from the various Shastras, and it is possible for a personality to convince people in these directions if they use Vedic Pramanas. So many personalities use Vedic Pramanas to convince their audience. Sri Adi Shankaracharya also did that. But we don't fully disagree with Adi Shankaracharya. We agree in certain portions also. We agree in certain portions. In which portions do we agree? We agree that Brahman is not, we say that Brahma is originally, you know, he is free from all material qualities. We agree with Adi Shankaracharya on that. What we disagree with is Brahma gets covered by Maya. We disagree with that. So many people don't get into these nitty-gritties of the philosophy. They read it on a surface level and then they become convinced by it. And once they become convinced, they are also emotionally attached to a certain personality. So they accept all the philosophical positions of that personality. So when that happens, then it is difficult to convince them otherwise. So that is what usually happens.
Prabhuji, in the upcoming 2 days of presentation, have you any plan of covering these terms like Nirvisheshvad, Shunyavad, Brahmavad?
I will give some detail I can give. But actually, these terms in itself deserve another session of their own. The Brahmavad and, you know, Nirvisheshvad. But I will mention some of them briefly. Because there are so many things which are, because in Jeev and Ishwar, tomorrow Jeev and Ishwar are going to be taken up. So that is something which is requires exhaustive treatment, and that we will be seeing tomorrow. So maybe in that discussion, some of these terms may come up, Prabhuji.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. One Mataji, Gopika Mataji is waiting.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna, my name is Venkat Govindas from Bangalore. Thank you very much for enlightening discussion. Prabhuji, I have two questions. One is, are you going to put up these presentations on YouTube so that you can offline also watch it?
Yeah, I'm going to put it on YouTube, and it will be available for individuals to see it.
Thank you very much. Second question is, when the Mayavadis are talking about impersonal Brahman, but most of them are worshippers of Lord Shiva.
So when they are speaking of, when the Advaitavadis, actually I don't like to use the term Mayavadis so much, because even if they are our philosophical opponents, this term is a pejorative term. Pejorative means it is used to insult a philosophical opponent. So the term which they use for themselves is Advaitavadis. Advaitavadis, they are ultimately worshippers of ultimately they want to merge into the impersonal Brahman, but they worship Shiva, Vishnu, Ganesh, Shakti, Surya, because they say that this is Saguna Brahma. Saguna Brahma means Brahma which has taken upon material qualities. So this is what they call Vishnu as Saguna Brahma. So they say that it is like, you know, you meditate on Saguna Brahma, like Vishnu, Shiva, Devi, and then you can merge into, ultimately you can merge into Nirguna Brahma. So the Saguna Brahma is like a stepping stone for merging into Nirguna Brahma. So for us, it is a very dangerous thought to think of Lord Vishnu as a stepping stone to merge into the impersonal Brahman. This is something which we should very carefully avoid thinking like that, because, you know, Archya Vishnu Shiladhir, in our worshipable deity, we should not consider them to be material. So they think that by worshipping Shiva, ultimately they will merge into Brahman. And Shiva is like a temporary form. So that is what their thought process is, which we do not agree with.
Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Broji. Broji, I don't find any more hands. So in case you allow, may I ask a few more questions from the session?
So one question from Shant Gopinathu. Okay.
Yes.
And then Jada Kapu can ask.
Shant Gopinathu, I cannot find his hand over here.
Okay, I think he has sent to me only. Under Shakha Bhed, it is generally seen that an empowered Acharya gives little new direction. So in our Sampradaya before Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, how many times it was changed or differently directed from Madhva Sampradaya?
What is the new direction that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave to the Sampradaya? Is this the essence of the question?
He's asking maybe what I've understood, that since like Sri Prabhupada made some kind of practical adjustments without compromising with the essential principles, he made some changes in the details of in terms of implementation of philosophy. So that phase, he's saying that, has this been done by the previous acharyas as well? So how many times has this been done so that we have made significant change from Madhva Sampradaya in a due course of time?
Yeah, yeah. Srila Prabhupada did not make any philosophical adjustment. First and for this thing, we should understand. There is no, Srila Prabhupada has made the practical day-to-day arrangement as far as conveying the philosophy is concerned. From a philosophical position, there is no adjustment that Srila Prabhupada has made. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what is the philosophical adjustment that he has made? That is given in the verse, Anarpita Charin Chirat Karunaya Avatirnah Kalau Samarpayatu Munnato Jvala Rasam Svabhakti Shreyam. That he has put above Dharma, Artha, Kam and Moksha, he has put Pancham Purushartha as Prema. And the attainment of that, specifically the attainment of Unnat Ujjwal Rasa, is an added thing which Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has introduced in the philosophy. That is the contribution of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. After Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all acharyas in the lineage of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu have given exactly that without making any change. I want to say this thing very specifically, because sometimes there is some thought process that Srila Prabhupada has again revolutionized the Sampradaya, but he has not changed any revolutionizing the Sampradaya means to change a philosophical tenet, which Srila Prabhupada has not done. So Srila Prabhupada has made the Sampradaya accessible to majority of people on the earth. This is Srila Prabhupada's, you know, unique contribution. But as far as the philosophical tenets are concerned, it is exactly the same as Srila Rupa Goswami. Absolutely no difference. So that is the answer to the question of Shyam Gopinath Prabhu.
Wonderful. I think Sudama Prabhu, he wants to be unmuted.
Yes, Puji. I have already unmuted him.
Okay. Prabhu, kindly unmute him. It seems like
I have unmuted him already earlier, but I cannot find his name now on the list.
Okay.
Maybe there is a question from Hrikesh Nityan and Ram too.
Okay, please.
May I say that? Yes. Prabhuji's question is, we know Sripad Madhavendra Puri is in the line of Madhava. How come he received title Puri?
We know that Sri Madhavendra Puri is in the line of Madhvacharya. how come he received the title of Puri. Yes. So there are one thing we have to understand. Shri Madhvacharya, did he start a separate line of sannyas? So the answer is no. Why? Because Madhvacharya himself was given sannyas by Shri Achyut Prekshak, who himself was belonging to Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. It's not that Madhvacharya started a brand new line of sannyas. He himself was given sannyas by a sannyasi from the Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. Now, whether a personality in Madhvacharya Sampradaya, there are tirthas, mainly there are tirthas. The sannyasis are given the title of tirthas. So just as Madhvacharya is known as Sri Ananda Tirtha, so their sannyasis are given the title of tirtha. So if there is a personality in the Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya, he should have been known as Tirtha. So why has he been given the title of Puri? So there are two answers, because historically we don't know so many of the details, but there are two possible answers. One answer is that Madhavendra Puri may have taken sannyas from Advaita Sampradaya, but he might have philosophically aligned with the Madhva Sampradaya. This is one answer. Or he might have gotten some mantras from Madhva Sampradaya, but taken sannyas from Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. Just as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he took sannyas from Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya, but his mantras were all Vaishnava mantras. So similarly, somebody's understanding can be completely Madhva, but they may end up taking sannyas from Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. Or another possibility is that a sannyasi from one title may have given another title to another sannyasi. That is also possible. But usually it is very rare. So these two possibilities are there in this regard. That is the answer.
Yes.
Shri Vatsa Prabhu is from USA. He wants to ask Oshin, but it's quite late in terms of his time.
Yes, yes.
Sure.
Yes, I have unmuted him.
Okay.
Krishna Prabhu, please. I had a question regarding treating Mayavadi and how to interact with them, because sometimes when we go on book distribution, or personally for me, when I interact with my family, who are also followers of Shankaracharya, not all of them, but some of them are aware of the philosophy and following it. But I was wondering how to interact with them, because also in the Krishna Samhita, Bhaktivinoda Thakur talks about how everyone should be respected in a sense, and how he even talks about how Shaktas and Shaivites, they're also Vaishnava in a way.
Right.
So, and he does say that impersonalism is the opposite of, it's direct opposite of Krishna consciousness, but at the same time he says that they should be respected. So it's hard for me to find a balance in the sense, because I found that when Krishna consciousness is directly challenged, I found the necessity to sometimes speak in a very strong way and quote Shastra in a very, very direct way, so that I can defend the philosophy properly and show that there's authority behind Mahaprabhu's words. So I was hoping I could get your feedback on that.
Yeah. So amongst all philosophers, we find different attitudes. For example, you know, in Adi Shankaracharya's Sampradaya also, there are many personalities who are not so vocal about their philosophy. And there are some personalities who are very vocal about their philosophy. Similarly, in the Madhva Sampradaya, there are certain personalities who are not so vocal about their philosophy, some who are very vocal about their philosophy. When we meet with a person, irrespective of their philosophical position, they may also be, you know, somebody who is not from a Vedic background. We meet any person who is a theist, somebody who is a believer in God, we should in general give respect to that person. But if that person starts provoking us by speaking something against Srimad Bhagavatam or the personal form of the Lord, so if the provocation comes from the other side, then Ninda, we said in the Bhagavatam, Ninda Bhagavatam Shrinvan Tatparasya Janasya Va Tato Nay Paiti Yasopi Yatyadha Sukritachyutaha. That one who does not leave the place, or one who does not counteract it, will fall from his piety. So one thing we can do is, if they are our seniors, elders, we can leave that place and go somewhere else till they calm down. Or if they are somebody who is equal to us, we can philosophically counteract. But Srila Prabhupada says in front of our seniors, those who are elder to us in age, seniors should not also be offered a verbal argument. This is what Srila Prabhupada says in his commentary to Bhagavad Gita. Because even they are our elders, if they are not, if they are repeatedly, insulting Bhagavan Vishnu's form, then maybe we can say something once or twice, but not more than that. Otherwise, we should leave the place and go somewhere else. But if there is a person who is of equal age, then we can try to counteract it philosophically. Or if it is not possible for us to counteract philosophically, we can leave that place. Those are the lines of action which should be followed by all Vaishnavas. And we should never personally target the character, especially the character of any spiritualist. Sometimes what happens is, while criticizing philosophy, we end up criticizing the personality. We should understand that personality of Adi Shankaracharya is very respectable for us. Srila Jiva Goswami has used Bahuvachan, plural case, in his Sandarbhas for Adi Shankaracharya, which means he has given immense respect to Adi Shankaracharya. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur in his commentary of Bhagavad Gita has used plural case for Madhusudan Saraswati, which means he has given respect for an impersonalist like Sri Madhusudan Saraswati. So we should understand that they are very respectable for us. We don't want to, insult their character. We are very respectful of them, but we are very much situated in contrast to their philosophical positions, and especially if they become vocal about it. That is the reply to your query.
Yes, Prabhuji. Sudama Prabhu can speak.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Prabhuji. And I have a question where it's like, if Sri Adi Shankaracharya preached Advaita philosophy, yeah, we also hear, especially in our preaching, where we say that, but in the end, Sri Adi Shankaracharya has sung Bhajagovindam, Bhajagovindam. Yeah. Is it after he realized that Krishna is the Supreme, that's why he said, or is it still the Saguna Tattva where Vishnu he accepts as helping means to go to Nirguna? Yeah. Is that the reason he sung?
Yeah, that is the reason. That is the reason why he sung Bhajagovindam. We Vaishnavas interpret that this was his final philosophical position, that ultimately, if you want to ask about Adi Shankaracharya, we should ask the people from Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. So, it's like if we want to ask about Madhvacharya, we will not go and ask somebody from Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. If we want to ask about Madhvacharya, we'll ask somebody from the Madhva Sampradaya. Similarly, if we want to ask about Adi Shankaracharya, we should ask from a person from Sri Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya. If you ask a person from their Sampradaya, they will say it was his explanation of Sagun Brahma, glorification of Sagun Brahma to ultimately merge into Nirguna Brahma. And that is what it is. Because many people say so many things about the last stages of Adi Shankaracharya's life. Some people say, a tantric convinced him to become a tantric. Some people say Vaishnavas convinced him to become a Vaishnava. this is against the purpose of life for which he was sent. According to the Vaishnavas only, he was sent by Lord Krishna to preach impersonalism, and he did that till the last breath of his life. That is what is the conclusion that should be accepted. He preached impersonalism till the last breath.
Okay. And then Prabhuji, we see also references where Prabhupada mentions that we accept also Adi Shankaracharya. And because Adi Shankaracharya has postulated this Advaita philosophy, so if we accepting it, it's like half hen concept, right? Where we are accepting only half of the philosophy and half of not. And this creates more how do we ensure that we still mature in Vaishnava philosophy when we still accept things?
Right. So when we say half hen, what is the meaning of half hen? Half hen means accepting one part of something and not accepting another part of it. That is called as Ardha Kukkuti Nyaya, yeah, or half hen logic. Half hen, accepting part of someone's philosophy and not accepting part of someone's philosophy is okay if it is done with a person. It is not okay when it is done with the Vedas. So Ardha Kukkuti Nyaya is not okay only when it is done with the Vedas. Or when we accept only from a personality, we are free to accept half of their teachings and not accept half of their teachings. But from the Vedas, we should not do this. We cannot say that we accept half the Vedas and reject half the Vedas. That we cannot do. as far as the Vedas are concerned, we accept entirety of Vedas. But as far as the different explanations of Vedas are concerned, we take part of all of them. So we should.
But then the personalities are using the Vedas as the references, right? So when they are basing on the basis of Vedas, so we are accepting half of their philosophy.
But so we are accepting half of their explanation of the Vedas. We are the Mool Vedas we are accepting in their entirety. But an a commentary on the Vedas, we are free whether we want to accept half of it or full of it or none of it.
Okay. And final question, Prabhuji, are you going to touch also the difference between Madhva philosophy and Sri Vaishnava philosophy in coming days?
There are minor differences. See, I will tell you one difference. One major difference between Madhva philosophy and Sri Vaishnava philosophy. Sri Vaishnava philosophy, if you ask who is the Nimitta Karan and Upadan Karan, what is the cause of the material universe? In Sri Ramanujacharya's philosophy, it is Brahma is the Nimitta Karan as well as Upadan Karan. And in Madhvacharya's philosophy, Hari is the Nimitta Karan and Prakriti is the Upadan Karan of the material world. Now, these are technical terms. What is Nimitta Karan and Upadan Karan, which I may not have time to explain. But those who understand these terms, they will understand what is the slight difference between Madhvacharya's philosophy and Ramanujacharya's philosophy. Other than that, Sri Ramanujacharya, Sri Madhvacharya sometimes feels that Sri Ramanujacharya has gone a little soft on Advaitavad when he should have taken an extreme position. And Sri Madhvacharya doesn't hesitate to go all the way and say it is not Vishisht Advait. Please don't, you know, when you say Vishisht Advait, you are still putting Advait in the picture. And just putting an ornament of Vishisht on it. So please don't do that. Just say Dvait. Come to the extreme other end and, you know, say Dvait. There is complete difference between Jeev and Brahman. Complete difference between, just don't, you know, put decorations on Advait. So that is what, you know, Madhvacharya is having slight difference of opinion with that. But other than that, as far as practice of bhakti is concerned, everything is concerned, they align on the same page. And as far as the final destination of the Jeevas is concerned, both accept that it is Vaikuntha in the eternal association of Lord Hari. So I think at the end of the day, even in Vaikuntha, some differences are going to remain. It's not that everybody has to stay on the same line, you know. So in Vaikuntha also, you know, Hanumanji will say, Lord Ram is the Supreme Personality of God. Anybody who challenges has to face me in a Gada Yudha. That is what he will say. So who wants to challenge that? Nobody wants to challenge that. So, you know, Vaikuntha is a place. One thing we have to understand that even in the spiritual world, you know, every masala is not garam masala. That is what we have to understand. Okay? So we have chaat masala, we have tejpatta, we have so many things. So similarly, as far as our personality of Vishnu is accepted, his Shakti is accepted, and Vishnu as the controller of Shakti is accepted, then you are eligible to enter Vaikuntha. Three things you should accept: personality of Vishnu, the Shakti of Vishnu, and Vishnu being the controller of the Shakti. These three things you accept, eligibility to enter Vaikuntha. That's all. Then for finer details, you can add your masala, whatever flavor you want. Okay, that is up to you. Okay. I hope that is.
Thank you very much, Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhuji. One devotee, in case Prabhuji is comfortable.
Yeah, I am comfortable. Any amount of time, till as long as Amogh Leela Prabhu doesn't ring the bell. Ting, ting, ting. Now it's okay. Over. Till that time, I'm okay.
Yeah. The Abhinandan Nitai Prabhu is, can
yes,
speak
sure.
now.
Yes, sure.
Hare Krishna. Yes, Prabhuji, even within Vaishnava Sampradaya, sometimes there are some philosophical discussions or debates which are like extremely difficult to reconcile. For example, this Jiva Faldam theory.
Hmm.
Now, many times what happens is that we ourselves find very difficult to understand and reconcile these issues. So when we have very difficult position with such philosophy, what should be our stance? What should be our attitude? Because many times such discussions did convert into mudslinging. They really become very bad. Second thing is that when any newcomer devotee also approaches us with such doubts, how should we tackle these kind of issues?
Right. So sometimes in Vaishnava Sampradaya there is some philosophical debate, even on some philosophical positions. And like, you know, in Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, there was philosophical debate about prapatti. Prapatti means how to surrender to the Supreme Lord. And Sri Venkatanath and Manavala Mamuni, both of them, they had conflicting opinions, and the Sampradaya had to split into two, which is Vadakalai and Tenkalai. They had to split into two branches because of this philosophical difference of opinion. Now, in our ISKCON, fortunately, we are still going, you know, in a single line. And although there have been philosophical debates about where the jiva originated, actually this discussion should have been resolved a long time ago. And it's very clearly mentioned by Srila Jiva Goswami in his Sandarbhas that once a jiva attains the spiritual world, the words of Jiva Goswami, tato askhalanam, a jiva never falls from the spiritual world. Now, Srila Prabhupada has spoken both positions, that jiva falls and doesn't fall. So, we can take ek vakyata, we can take one single line of thought, that if Jiva Goswami has said that the jiva doesn't fall from the spiritual world, Srila Prabhupada has also some places said that jiva doesn't fall, some places said he falls. So, we will take one line of thought which will make everybody fall in the same line, that the jiva doesn't fall from the spiritual world, because that is what Prabhupada also says and Jiva Goswami also says. So we can, once what will establish ek vakyata or one line of thought, that is what should be done, and that is what should be practiced and preached to all the devotees. Sometimes for preaching we say we were in the spiritual world, then we became envious and we fell down, and that's all right for preaching, but later Siddhanta should be explained that Maya cannot enter the spiritual world and make the jiva envious of Krishna. Though Siddhanta should also be explained at a later stage to a devotee. So that is what should be done.
Guruji, also one thing what happens is, in such philosophical discussion, even though we have complete respect for our Sampradaya Acharya, any opinion if we express, somebody labels us that you are anti, you are against the Acharya. How can you speak like this? I mean, it may just be an opinion or it may be a doubt. So that makes us really feel very bad.
Yeah. So, Abhinandan Prabhu, one should never enter into a discussion with such people. Such people are Vitandavadis. Because people who are there just to give label unto others, you are this, you are that, such people are not worthy of any discussion. They are there only for Vitandavad. In Nyaya Shastra, such people are called as Vitandavadis. Vitandavadis means they don't have any position by themselves to establish. They just want to destroy your position and give you labels and names. Yeah, you are anti this Acharya, you are anti that Acharya. In fact, you are not. You are actually devoted to Srila Prabhupada. You are devoted to our society. But they will just, for Vitandavad, I call them Kalahapriya. You know what is Kalahapriya? Kalahapriya means, yeah, this is their juice of life, Prabhu. They love to, you know, smash other people in the face with boots. You know, that is what they want to do in their life. That is the rus that they get. You know, that is what they want to do. So somebody is Kalaha Priya. One thing I always do in our society, one thing I always do, my humble recommendation. Anybody who is only refuting others, but who cannot offer Hari Katha of equal or greater quantity should not be, you know, is not ideally a person whom I will listen to. If somebody is so much into philosophy, then speak Hari Katha. Show us your attraction to Krishna. Don't just simply remain in the negative domain. Show us how much you are in the positive domain. If somebody is more and more attached to Hari Katha, then maybe they speak little strong words. That I can accept. But if somebody has made their entire life speaking on strong words and no lesser attraction to Hari Katha, then I would rather stay at some distance from such personality. That is my answer to your query.
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you very much.
Yes, in case Amoghlira Prabhuji allows, so may I ask a few questions? Yes, Prabhuji. Actually, as you have said during the session, that as according to capacity of jiva, jiva experiences bliss. So that is defined as liberation. Right. So Prabhuji, are we talking about the swaroop of the individual soul? Is this capacity means swaroop?
the swaroop of the in the swaroop of the jiva there are different gradations in moksha. So when there are different gradations in moksha, that is Sri Madhvacharya's philosophy. And even within the material world, he will specify gradations of jivas. So that is also a part of his philosophy, that there are some nitya tamasic jivas. Some jivas are very tamasic, and they are going to stay in the material world for a long, long time. So those jivas are also there. So that Madhvacharya will be covering in those sections. And there are some jivas who are going to go back to Godhead because they are nirdhut kashaya, freed of all the material entanglements. So those jivas will also be there. There is taratamya, there is hierarchy in those jivas. That will be covered in those sections.
Okay. And Prabhuji, as you said that Maya is also, as per the philosophy of Shripad, Adi Shankaracharya. You tell that Maya is also controlled by the Lord even in his saguna form. So my point here in this was that being in saguna form, he is controller of the Maya, but at the same time, being controller, he chose to be in the Maya. So that also proves that he is having more bliss in the personal form, rather than in impersonal form, because he is choosing, then only he is sustaining that form.
Sure. But if you accept this, then you're falling to another trap.
Yeah.
But the trap is, the form is temporary. So when he wants, he will remove that form. Will you accept that position, Jai Dwarka Prabhu? Or will you come to Jeev Goswami school, where Jeev Goswami says all forms of the Lord are eternal? They are ever existing forms, never were made out of Maya. Even all the forms of the Lord are eternal forms. They are made out of, they are expressions of His Swarup Shakti. That is why it is called Swarup Shakti. Na? Unki Swarup hi unki Shakti hai. His Swarup is made out of His Shakti. That is why she is called as Swarup Shakti. So that is the position, that is the school I want to go to. I want to go to that. I don't want as a patchwork, that I don't want. What I want is, I want a pakka school. Pakka school is where I don't want any patchwork. That is Jeev Goswami school. I want Sandarbha school. I want to enroll in the graduation school of the six Sandarbhas. That is what I want to do. And I recommend that to you, Jai Dwarka Prabhu, because you look like a candidate who should graduate from the University of Six Sandarbhas.
Actually, yes.
No, Prabhuji. So, Prabhuji, one more question regarding the creation, which you told that Brahman is sometimes said to be the creator in Vedas, many people quote. So, Prabhuji, I would like to, just to have an understanding from different perspective, only for that sake, I will quote a few shlokas in case you allow me.
Sure.
So, Prabhuji, as Srila Prabhupada tells, and also in Srimad Bhagavatam, there comes a verse in Canto 2, Chapter 5, verse number 11. Yena swarochi shavishyam rochitam rochiyame ham yathar kogne yathar soma yathariksa grahatarka. And in this verse, Srila Prabhupada is explaining, and he's also quoting from Brahma Samhita, yasya prabha prabhavato jagadanda koti. Then there Srila Prabhupada is explaining that how creation happens from the Brahma Jyoti of the Lord, from the Brahman effulgence of the Lord. So impersonal Brahman is acting for the creation. And there comes another verse, Prabhuji, in again 2:10:45, which tells nasya karmani janmado parasyanu vidhiyate to kartritu parishyadhartam maya rochitam hitat. No engineering is directly done by the Lord. So, but still it is told so that the Maya is not said to be the one acting. And again, there I have Padma Puran version of a few verses where it is said that Lord is explaining that why I am told as Nishkriya, because I do not act in creation. So Lord is explaining this in a verse from a Padma Puran. So how do we understand this, all these things? So that's why only I quoted a few verses, not
otherwise. First thing is, is Brahma Nishkriya or Sakriya? First thing we have to ask. Is Brahma, impersonal Brahman, Nishkriya or Sakriya? Because if we say Brahma is Sakriya, that is Brahma has capability to act, then we are imposing a quality upon Brahma. This nobody can deny. Because Brahma can be qualityless only when it is Nishkriya. As soon as you make Brahma Sakriya, you are putting aarop. Aarop means you are putting an allegation of a quality on Nishkriya Brahma. So as soon as you have Brahma with qualities, then the question is, are these qualities material qualities or spiritual qualities that Brahma has? If you say material qualities, you are Adi Shankaracharya. If you say spiritual qualities, you are Ramanujacharya. That is the simple thing. I hope you are able to understand. So Brahma creates, Brahma accepts qualities, which qualities? So the answer to that question determines your sampradaya. That is, if you say material qualities, Brahma takes material qualities, then Adi Shankaracharya. If you say Brahman is having eternal spiritual qualities, Ramanujacharya. And if you say, no, not Brahma, Krishna is the direct creator, then welcome to Madhvacharya Sampradaya. That is what is, because, so these are some hair-splitting differences between the schools of philosophy, and every verse in the Bhagavatam can be interpreted according to the Vaishnava version. It is by default to be interpreted according to the Vaishnava version. Therefore, there is no Adi Shankaracharya Sampradaya commentary on Srimad Bhagavatam. That is very clear.
Yes, yes. Puji, one thing is about understanding the philosophy, and another thing is the verses which they say directly. Just like Krishna is just the Padma Purana version which I am quoting here, Lord Krishna himself is telling to Shivji that I am told as Nishkriya. So, and again, that 2, 10, 11, there Srila Prabhupada is explaining in purport also that if I read over here, I create after Lord's creation by his personal effulgence known as Brahma Jyoti, just as the sun manifests its fire, moon and firmament, the influential planets and the twinkling stars also manifest their brightness. So, so how do you understand the verses directly they themselves say?
Yeah, so if you send me, if I am able to, I'll look into the Sanskrit of this. And once I look into the...
I can share screen, Prabhuji.
Yes, you can share the screen with me. And I'll look into the Sanskrit. And what I will do is, I will see what is the interpretation done by our previous acharyas. Yes. Yeah. येन स्वरोचिषा विश्वं रोचितं रोचयाम्यहं यथार्कोग्निर् यथा सोमो यथार्क्ष ग्रह तारकः. So येन, by whom, स्वरोचिषा, by his effulgence, विश्वं रोचितं, विश्वं रोचितं, प्रभु रोचितं here is said already created. Okay, but रोचितं can also be interpreted as illuminated. So he who has illuminated the world by his illumination.
Okay, yes, yes.
I hope you are able to understand. That is the
Yes.
Okay, you can take that interpretation. And I think that interpretation is closer to the Sanskrit.
Yes, Foji.
Huh?
So Foji.
That's the answer to your query.
Yes, Foji. And Proji, may I ask one more question?
That's up to Amog Lila Prabhu. As long as Amog Lila Prabhu allows, you can ask. I am enlivened by the queries, no problem.
Yes, Prabhuji, may I ask Amog Lila Prabhuji?
Haan, bilkul sir, mere malik pucho.
Yes, Prabhuji, how come these Mayavadis, they have chosen only five deities out of all so many other forms? So is there any specific reason or somewhere mentioned in somewhere that these are five special deities?
See, the Advaitavadis, they find that in most Shastras, these five personalities are glorified. Puranas, Itihasas, Mahabharata, Ramayana, and Stotras. These five personalities are ultimately glorified the most. And therefore, they have said that it is called as Pancha Upasana. Upasana can be of any Vedic Tattva, any Vedic deity. But amongst all Upasanas, Pancha Upasana is the considered to be the best according to the Advaitavadis. Yes, because these pancha tattvas of the Advaitavadis are glorified most in the Vedic literature. Shiva, Ganesh, Devi, Vishnu and Surya. That is the answer.
Yes, Prabhuji. And Prabhuji, what the most confusing thing when we come to personal understanding is that when we accept a personality, personality has a form, and we define that Krishna is supreme personality.
Right.
So what is that? There should something exist outside the personality to make the form. Just like my personality is there because I'm standing in space and there's something separated from my form. That's why the form can be created. Hmm. So what is, I think you got my question.
There should be a space-time continuum to contain a personality. That is what you're saying, right?
Yes.
In mathematical terms, from an engineer's person, thank God I did some engineering and I remembered some of it to answer this question. So there should be a space-time continuum for a madhyam akar, a limited form, to exist within that space-time. That is what is your... So the answer to your query is given by Jiva Goswami in his Bhagavat Sandarbha when he takes up that verse from the Bhagavatam where Mother Yashoda looks into the mouth of Krishna. Na chantar na bahiryasya na purvam na pichar param purva param bahis chantar jagatoyo jagatchaya. That he was having a madhyam akar, a limited form, but when she gazed into his mouth, she saw that there were universes within him. So how is this possible? He is having a limited form and at the same time he is all pervasive. That is what Mother Yashoda saw. That, you know, he is having a limited form and he is all pervasive. This is called as mutually contradictory quality. How can somebody be limited and at the same time be unlimited? So that is the place where this Jiva Goswami starts explaining the philosophy and says that Bhagavan is the harmonization of mutually contradictory qualities. Please try to understand. This is Bhagavan. Bhagavan is the harmonizer of mutually contradictory qualities. He is omnipresent and at the same time has a medium form, madhyamakar. That is what Bhagavan is. And how is he able to do that simultaneously? For example, material things can't achieve this. If a water has filled half the glass, it has filled half the glass. It cannot be simultaneously filling half the glass and full the entirety of glass. Yes. And that is material. It has a limitation. But Krishna is such a personality that it may appear that he is filling half the glass, but simultaneously he has also filled the entire glass. That is, you know, in layman's terms, what Krishna is. Krishna is madhyam akar, he has a medium form, and at the same time Krishna is sarvagata. He is present everywhere in the universe. And this mutual contradiction is harmonized in Krishna only. And then Jiva Goswami quotes many Shastra Pramans from Narasimha Thapaniya Upanishad. Ugram, anugram, viram, aviram, mahantam, amahantam, sarvatomukham, asarvatomukham. Sarvatomukham, everywhere are his faces. Asarvatomukham, everywhere are not his faces. So, how are these mutually contradictory qualities present in him? So, the mutually contradictory qualities are present in him only because he is Bhagavan and he can, his shaktis act in such a way. When Krishna was speaking Bhagavad Gita to Arjun, in 11th chapter, he showed his all-pervasive form. Does it mean that in first chapter, his form was limited and not all-pervasive? Question is this. The answer is no. In all chapters, his form was simultaneously limited and all pervasive. It's only when Arjun was given the vision that he could see and Arjun only could see only one form at a time, not both forms. So Arjun said, oh, please remove this form and show that form. So that is the limitation of the Jiva, that they can only see one form at a time. So I don't want to make the entire class so philosophical. So I will introduce some rus into this. Okay. So this is where Sri Hari Suri's guru comes. And he says, at this point of time, Sri Hari Suri's guru comes and says, just see the glories of the dust of Vrindavan. See how glorious the dust of Vrindavan is. One little child ate little particles of the dust of Vrindavan. And those particles of dust turned into entire universe within his mouth. See, the glory of the dust of Vrindavan. This is, you know, it's not the glory of Bhagavan Krishna. It is the glory of the dust of Vrindavan. It's only after Krishna ate the dust of Vrindavan, every particle turned into a planet of its own and manifested the entire universe. See, can there be anything more glorious than the dust of Vrindavan? Jai Dwarka Prabhu, please tell me.
No.
this is from a rasic point of view, you know, but for these 2-3 days we are going to scrape our heart with sandpaper little bit so that we can, you know, analyze tattva nicely.
Perfect. yes and Prabhuji, we hear so many pastimes of the jivas coming from Goloka or from some Vaikuntha by doing some offense, or kafi. We also hear so many quotations in scriptures that you do this and then you will go for one kalpa in Vaikuntha. So how do we understand this?
So Jiva Goswami explains that in Sandarbha. Therefore, I said, for all these, we should graduate from the Sandarbha universe. In the Sandarbha, he explained that there is a Vaikuntha in this universe. It is called as Prapanchik Vaikuntha. Prapanchik Vaikuntha means Dhruv Maharaj was given a Vaikuntha within this universe. Within the material universe, there was a Vaikuntha made for him. That Vaikuntha is called as Prapanchik Vaikuntha, a Vaikuntha within the material world. So there are some Jivas who have performed Bhakti Sukriti. They have pulled the cart of Lord Jagannath. They have circumambulated the temple of Lord Jagannath. They have done all this. But they have not attained Prema as of now. They have not become Nirdhut Kashaya. So, and Shastra has promised them, if you do this, you will get this. You do that, you get that. Fair enough. So, Lord Krishna, according to his desire, can give them some experience of Prapanchik Vaikuntha and then send them back to continue their bhakti. So, whenever it is said that you will be given Vaikuntha for so many days, some, you know, it's like promising a holiday package for, you know, 7 nights, you know, 8 days, 7 nights. But then you have to return back na, after the holiday. Then to return back go back to your corporate world and suffer there. That's what happens, you know. So, the Rupa Goswami says in Bhakti Rasamrit Sindhu, the aim of such promises given in Shastra is to encourage people to perform bhakti. His exact words are Bahirmukha, for it is for the Bahirmukha people. That, you know, but kintu mukhyam phalam ratihi. This is Rupa Goswami's word. The main fruit is that they should be able to develop rati or attraction to Krishna. That is the purpose of such statements. So sometimes such statements are also what is called as arthavad, overly glorified statements. You will get this if you lie down once. It's called arthavad. Arthavad means some over eulogy. So everywhere arthavad is there, may be there. But in one case, there is no arthavad. When scriptures are glowing, Harinam is glorified, there is no arthavad. In everything else, there can be arthavad. But in one place, there is no arthavad when scriptures are glorifying. That is Harinam. Harinam, there is, because if I say that there is arthavad in Harinam, then the entire lecture will become non-bona fide. So there may be arthavad in some other activities of bhakti, but in Harinam, there is no arthavad. This is the, you know, strong conclusion of studying all the Purana. Sometimes we'll find some arthavad that once, you know, once you circumambulate the rath, you will not have to see the material world again. So of course you have to, you know, you're not, if you're not attained prema, you may have to see it again. But Rupa Goswami says such statements are for encouraging devotees on the path of bhakti. And second thing is, it is also literally correct, because once you have circumambulated the rath, your path to going back to Godhead has started. So after a few lives, you will not have to see the material world again. So, you know, it may not happen immediately. It will happen ultimately. So all scriptural statements are ultimately true. Whether they are immediately true is up to Lord Krishna's desire. It can also become immediately true, as he did in the case of Ajamil. You know, Ajamil named his son Narayan. And once he chanted Narayan, you know, Ajamil, you know, went back to Godhead. And I named my son Hari. And I'm calling him every day so many times and still nothing is happening, Prabhu. So, something, you know, there is some difference in, you know, Ajamil's case and my case. Even though we both named our sons after the Lord's name. So the thing is, Jiva Goswami says that Sakrit Uccharitam Yena Hariritiksharadvayam Baddha Parikarastena Mokshaya Gamanam Prati. If one has chanted Harinam even once, they have started on the path of moksha. Okay? But doesn't mean that they have immediately reached. Just as if, you know, just as if Amogh Leela Prabhu goes from Iskon Dwarka to Iskon east of Kailash. And somebody asks you, where is Amogh Leela Prabhu? You'll say, oh, he has gone to east of Kailash. He may be on the way, but you will say, oh, he's gone to east of Kailash. Aisa he will say. So similarly, scriptures say, one who has chanted Harinam has gone back to Godhead. But he is on the path back to Godhead. If you ask Amogh Lila Prabhu right now where you are, he'll say, I am somewhere between Dwarka and east of Kailash. So similarly, yes, if you ask a jiva in reality where he is after performing these activities, he is somewhere between his initial Shraddha and Prema. That is the logical answer given by Srila Jiva Goswami. So I hope that is understood.
So Bhuji, as you said, just Yannama Shruti Matrena Puman Bhavati Nirmalaha, there comes a verse in Srimad Bhagavatam, a person becomes just by hearing one's name. So what to speak of chanting? So chanting to offer, it is another next level. So kaise lein, Bhuji?
So by hearing also it can happen. But Yannama Shruti Matrena, it becomes Nirmala. Because Nirmala means they are on the path of becoming Nirmala. That's how Jiva Goswami. Okay. Please try to, this is all, please remember the analogy that Amogh Lila Prabhu has gone to east of Kailash. Does it mean that he has already reached there? Because the statement literally means that he is in east of Kailash right now. But that may not be the truth. He is somewhere in between. So please remember that verse you should memorize, Prabhuji. Sakrut Uccharitam Yena Harir Ityaksharadvayam Baddha Parikarastena Mokshaya Gamanam Prati. एक बार जिसने नाम लिया हरि का उसने कमर कस ली है मोक्ष के मार्ग पे. तो कमर कस, यू हैव यू नो कमर कस लेना मतलब क्या, इट इज नॉट, इट डजंट मीन दैट यू हैव रीच्ड देयर, इट मींस दैट यू हैव रोल्ड अप योर स्लीव्स राइट नाउ. सो दैट इज व्हाट वी शुड अंडरस्टैंड.
यस, सो जी माय क्वेश्चंस आर एंडलेस बट फ्यू डिवोटीज आई एम वेटिंग, दे हैव रेज्ड देयर हैंड. सो बलि मैं पू कैन आस्क. सो ही इज अनम्यूटेड.
हरे कृष्ण प्रभु जी, धन्यवाद, थैंक यू सो मच प्रभु जी. So Prabhuji, my question is, like you explained already that Jiva, he cannot fall from spiritual world. So can you please kindly explain the mechanism how he came to this material world, Prabhuji?
There is no mechanism of falling into material. Please try to understand. This question is taken up in Vedanta Sutra. It is Atmadhikarana. Atmadhikarana is there in Vedanta Sutra. And you should, if those devotees who are interested in such philosophical topics should refer to Govinda Bhashya also. Atmadhikaran is there in Vedanta Sutra. Atmadhikaran means Vyasadeva has tackled this question, what is the origin of Atma in the material world? So at the end of the day, Vyasadeva also in the Vedanta Sutra says, it is pointless to meditate upon this because Shastra is also maun about, quiet about this. This is the conclusion of Atmadhikaran. That it is ultimately how the Jiva originated in the material world is pointless to understand because the circumstances in which the Jiva came to the material world are not described in Shastra. Shastra only describes what to do after you have come here and how to get out of here. That's what Shastra describes. And Jiva Goswami gives some explanation of it in Bhagavad Sandar. He says that the Jiva is on the border and Maya snares the Jiva away from Ishwar. That is what he, in Paramatma Sandarbha also he says this, that the Jivas on the border are snared away. He gives some statements like that. So that is the, there are some statements in the Bhagavat and Paramatma Sandarbha of that nature, which can be interpreted like that. Otherwise, there is no statement in the Sandarbhas at least, which say that the Jiva comes from the spiritual world, he has fallen, because from Jiva Goswami's perspective, it is very obvious that the Jiva never falls from the spiritual world. So that is the answer to your query.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Yes, Prabhuji, one more devotee, Shivam Prabhu is also waiting.
Sure.
So I'm just, I think he has left now.
Okay.
So, Prabhuji, may I continue with the questions or I think it must be late for you. In case.
What we'll do is, because the recording should also, I think the recording is now 2 hours 40 minutes. So I think we'll pause at this point of time. I'm happy to answer any number of questions, but my wife is not very happy. That's the difference between Brahmacharya Ashram and Grihastha Ashram. So Grihastha, he has an invisible force behind him, which, you know, is not visible immediately. I'm just joking, Prabhu. But we can take up other questions tomorrow. But I love your spirit of Jigyasa. and I encourage you to continue on the spirit of Jigyasa. I want more questions, Prabhu. But Jigyasa is simply question, much better than question and answers is to read the Sandarbhas by yourself, because many questions will be solved by reading the Sandarbhas in detail. So that is my, you know, humble recommendation, that so many questions will be solved simply by reading the six Sandarbhas. Otherwise, people will, you know, my Guru Maharaj, one time he named one person Prashnacharya. I said, whenever he used to come to Jew, my Guru Maharaj, he would ask one question. Every class, he will ask one question. My Guru Maharaj said, "Are you are Prashnacharya." So, from Prashnacharya, we have to become Uttaracharya. So, Jai Dwarka Prabhu, you should become Uttaracharya. You should also be able to convince other people. So, that is what I want.
You have blessed him, Prabhuji. So, he will now.
Yes.
You have blessed him.
Yes. So, please also study so much that you can give answers. You can convince others, Prabhu. I was also Prashnacharya at one point of time. I used to ask so many questions, but then later I understood that it is much better to study and get the basics and all the philosophical things cleared, because questions will be there. It let them remain, but we do our main task of studying. Then gradually they will go away. That is the
question. Puli, and thank you so much, Puli, for this enlightenment. I remember the words which you quoted last time and which we have framed about Srila Rupa Goswami. I would like to say, as I have remembered that, so so this is a verse which is composed by Prabhuji only. Shuddhyartha mama dehasya jala snanam karomi ham Shri Rupa Vakasudha snanam Shri Rupa Vakasudha snanam swatmanah parishuddhe. So this is
for my daily ritualistic purification, I take bath using water, but for the purification of my soul, I take a daily bath in the nectar of the words of Srila Rupa Goswami.
Wow. Amazing. Amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Amog Leela Prabhu.
Thank you
so much.
Thanks to you, Prabhuji. You know, we should be thankful to you. You are taking out your precious time to bless all of us. You gave us more than, I think, 2 hours, 45 minutes almost. So that's your greatness. And yet with such enthusiasm, with such affection, you are answering our queries, Prabhuji. So we are actually grateful to you. As you were mentioning in your lecture, that in between, you know, as the course of time, there are devotees, they come and they heighten the parampara and the teachings. So that is, you are one such devotee who is highlighting the importance of reading the words of our acharyas and in line with Srila Prabhupada. And that's a beauty, Prabhuji. And you are doing that so beautifully. People like me, we can bring people to Krishna consciousness with our Nautanki Bhaji, but actually when they become devotees, they can be nourished by this Harikatha, which you are doing, Prabhuji. So
I strongly object to that. I object to that because if you see from a perspective, I am also a word juggler. Sanskrit means word juggler, Prabhu. What it is. So this Sanskrit and grammar, it's all word. We are doing some Nautanki Bhaji on the philosophical domain. Nothing else, Prabhuji. Nothing like that, Prabhu. But I really, it is said that I would like to say something, that the fact that you are blessed with the ability to attract so many millions of individuals to Krishna Bhakti, and simply by seeing you, they say Hare Krishna and they know who is Amog Leela Prabhu. So I have one very strong desire, Prabhu, because I don't give classes without some Dakshina. So I have some Dakshina to ask. You have to give me some Dakshina, which I will ask you at the end of the 3 sessions. Yes. Okay. Without Dakshina, Yajyam Adakshinam, it is said in the mode of ignorance, Bhagavad Gita says, any Yajna which is done without Dakshina is... So I will publicly ask you at the end of the... How much Lakshmi I want, I will ask you, Prabhu. Okay?
I'll come to your home and do anything.
No, it's not Lakshmi Dakshina, but I will ask something from you. I hope you will not refuse my request.
Not at all. I am saying yes to it.
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you. Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
Thank you so much. Jai His Grace Hari Parshad Prabhuji Ki Jai.
Jai.
Prabhupada Ki Jai. Hare Krishna.
Prabhupada Ki Jai.
Jai.
Thank you very, very much, Prabhuji. So grateful to you. Hare
Krishna. Jai Shri Prabhupada.
Thank you, Prabhupada.